Shalom, Most High, Christ bless y'all. How y'all doing? Happy Sabbath, Shabbat Shalom. Glad to be here. Can't wait till we're back to our regular schedule with a full house. You know, but this is what we got to work with. Officer Lemuel, are you reading for me today, sir? All right. Today we are going to, the title is called The New World Order. I'm pretty sure all of y'all are familiar with that saying, The New World Order. You know what's crazy? I seen a video from a camp. I'm not gonna say who the brother is. They're pretty popular. But the brother was talking about vaccinations. It seems like he was taking shots at Israel United in Christ. But the brother was talking about vaccinations and so forth. So I'm listening and I'm like, damn, just like today with Deacon's class, where he said how people just don't mind their business. But this camp, they teach that the planets are angels, there's mermaids. They teach all sorts of crazy stuff, but you never hear us take shots at them or bring stuff up. I just wanted to say that. They also teach that Moab, I don't know if they still teach it, but I know one time they did say that Moab is the next superpower on this earth. How many of y'all believe that? And what scripture is that? Is there a scripture that said that Moab is the next superpower on this earth? No, the answer is no. Okay, so like I said, today we're gonna talk about the New World Order. The New World Order. Let's open up with this video first.
The modern United States is the most powerful country in human history, with over 800 military bases and 37% of global military spending. The U.S. has become the leader of a vast, interconnected global system that has helped usher in an era of unprecedented prosperity and low levels of conflict. To understand America's position in the world, and why it's so pivotal for world politics as we know it, you have to go back to the country's founding, back to when America wasn't a global power in any sense of the word. During the first 70 years of its existence, the United States expanded in both territory and influence in North America, eventually reaching the Pacific Ocean, in a wave of expansionism that resulted in the wholesale slaughter of the indigenous people who populated the continent. But early Americans were deeply divided as to whether the country should expand beyond the Pacific and Atlantic Oceans. This became a major debate after the Civil War, when some leaders, like post-war Secretary of State Seward, argued that America should push to become a global power. Seward succeeded in pushing a plan to purchase Alaska from Russia, but his attempts to buy Greenland and Iceland, as well as annex territory in the Caribbean, were all blocked by Congress. That's because some Americans, including many on Capitol Hill, had a strong anti-imperialist bent. These people worried about America getting more involved in global politics, as well as having to integrate populations from quote-unquote inferior races. And this opposition implied major checks on the imperialist urge to expand. But something was happening in the late 1800s that would change the debate about American expansionism. The Industrial Revolution produced explosive economic growth, and the bigger U.S. economy required a more centralized state and bureaucracy to manage the growing economy. Power became concentrated in the federal government, making it easier for expansionist presidents, like William McKinley, to unilaterally push American influence abroad. The key turning point came in 1898, when President McKinley dragged the country into war with Spain over Cuba, despite some intense domestic opposition. The rising United States easily defeated the moribund Spanish Empire, acquiring Puerto Rico, Guam, and the Philippines in the process. Over the next 2 years, the U.S. would annex the Kingdom of Hawaii, Wake Island, and American Samoa. A few years later, the U.S. took control of the Panama Canal Zone and sent troops to occupy the Dominican Republic. It also purchased the American Virgin Islands. This period of rapid acquisition of far-flung territories put the U.S. on the map as a truly global power. During this time, America also began using its influence to protect its growing commercial and military interests abroad, installing pro-American regimes in places like Nicaragua, and playing a major role in international diplomacy regarding the Western presence in China. World War I showed just how much America's influence had grown. Not only was American intervention a decisive factor in the war's end, but President Wilson attended the Paris Peace Conference, which ended the war, and attempted to set the terms of the peace. He spearheaded America's most ambitious foreign policy initiative yet, an international organization called the League of Nations, designed to promote peace and cooperation globally. The League, a wholesale effort to remake global politics, showed just how ambitious American foreign policy had become. Yet isolationism was still a major force in the United States. Congress blocked the United States from joining the League of Nations, dooming Wilson's project. During the Great Depression and the rise of Hitler, the U.S. was much more focused on its own region than on European affairs. Ultimately, America's ever-growing entanglements abroad made it impossible for it to stay out of global affairs entirely. In East Asia, the growing Japanese Empire posed a direct threat to American possessions and troops, bringing the United States and Japan into conflict. This culminated in the Pearl Harbor attack, bringing the United States into World War II. World War II would transform America's global presence forever. The United States was the only major power to avoid economic ruin during the war, and it was the sole country equipped with atomic weapons. As such, it was in a unique position to set the terms of the peace, and, with the aim of preventing another war in mind, it took advantage. The most famous example of this is the creation of the United Nations. The UN Charter set up a system of international law prohibiting wars of conquest, like the ones waged by the Nazis and the Japanese. It also served as a forum in which the international community could weigh in on disputes and help resolve them. This way, the Americans hoped, great powers could resolve their differences through compromise and law rather than war. But while the UN is the most famous of the post-war institutions, it isn't the only one. 730 delegates from all 44 allied nations came together in a small vacation haven in New Hampshire. Their goal? To establish a global financial system that would prevent another Great Depression and World War. The resulting agreement, called the Bretton Woods Agreement, ultimately became the backbone of the global financial system, resulting in the World Bank and the International Monetary Fund. By creating these institutions, the United States committed itself to being deeply involved in the world's problems. The issue, though, is that the world's second largest power, the Soviet Union, saw things differently. World War II had made allies out of the Democratic West and Communist East in the fight against Hitler, but that couldn't last. The United States saw Soviet expansion in Eastern Europe and elsewhere as a direct threat to its vision of a free-trading, democratic world.
To a substantial degree, in one form or another, socialism has spread the shadow of human regimentation over most of the nations of the earth, and the shadow is encroaching upon our own liberty.
Fearful of Soviet intentions towards Western Europe, the US and other European nations created the North Atlantic Treaty Organization, a military alliance meant to stop Russia from invading other countries in Europe. Globally, the US committed to a strategy called containment, so-called because it was aimed at containing the spread of communism everywhere on the globe. This new global struggle meant that the US had to exert influence everywhere, all the time. Instead of disbanding the massive military machine created for World War II, the wheels mostly kept turning. This had two main results. First, the US was pulled into unlikely alliances with countries like Saudi Arabia, Israel, and South Korea, seeing each of them as bulwarks against communist influence in their region. Secondly, the US began intervening, often secretly, in dozens of countries to contain Soviet influence. Sometimes this meant propping up sympathetic dictators, like in Iran. Other times, it meant supplying rebels with arms and money, like in Afghanistan in 1979 and Nicaragua in 1985. Over the course of the Cold War, the US intervened in hundreds of disputes around the globe, ending up with a complicated set of alliances, tensions, and relationships in basically every corner of the earth. After the Berlin Wall fell, the US could have withdrawn from the system, severing ties with its allies and drawing down the size of its military. And while the US did decrease military spending, much of the military infrastructure and alliances from the Cold War remained. Presidents George H.W. Bush and Bill Clinton decided that it was in both America and the world's interests for the United States, now the sole superpower on Earth, to continue actively managing global affairs.
We should be and we must be peacemakers.
NATO, created solely as a tool for countering the Soviet Union, stayed together and even expanded, a way of keeping European nations united in the absence of the Soviet threat. Washington's support for countries like Israel and Japan stayed intact, ostensibly as a means of preventing war in their respective regions. The global system of alliances and institutions created to keep the peace during the Cold War became permanent, as did the American military and political commitments necessary to keep them running. This system remains in operation today, and no leading American politician since the Cold War has seriously called for dismantling it. Except, perhaps, for Donald Trump. Trump has said contradictory things about these commitments, but he's consistently argued that American allies are not paying the US enough for its protection, and questioned the value of free trade. That calls NATO and even the World Trade Organization into question.
At some point, we have to say, you know what? We're better off if Japan protects itself against this maniac in North Korea. We're better off, frankly, if South Korea is going to start to protect itself.
Saudi Arabia, we have weapons?
Saudi Arabia, absolutely.
This is a sharp divergence from the consensus that has dominated U.S. foreign policy since 1945, and something closer to the isolationism that came before it. So will President Trump act on some of candidate Trump's ideas and reverse decades worth of institution building and alliances? We'll find out soon enough.
Shalom, leadership, happy Sabbath.
Yes, sir. Most High in Christ bless.
I noticed that they took control of the world currency by opening up a World Bank.
World Bank came from the Bretton Woods Conference, and then the World Bank came out of there. Also, you had the IMF. Okay? Y'all know what the IMF is, right? Y'all heard about that before. Okay? And you also had what else? What other key points did you pull from this video? Milkema. Officer Milkema.
Yeah. They formed NATO so that they can block out Russia from doing anything with anybody else. And then they established all these posts out throughout the world.
Okay. So NATO was formed primarily to block off the Soviet Union, the former Soviet Union, from expanding, all right, before it broke up into Russia and its different countries. Remember I told you to keep in mind the woman, the cartoon, Lady Liberty. Keep that in mind as well as we move on in the class. Let's open up with Habakkuk chapter 2. We're going to read 2 to 3.
Habakkuk chapter 2, verse 2. Mm-hmm. And the Lord answered me and said, write the vision and make it plain upon tables.
So the Most High, when he speaks, he makes things plain, okay? He makes things plain. Those things that are not plain, he'll give it to certain brothers, like, for example, the bishop who's blessed with the Spirit to bring out certain prophecies and so forth and deep, deep, deep breakdowns based upon what? Precept upon precept. So God says he makes things plain upon tables. What are the tables? What is the table? Right there, you. Mm-hmm. Say your name again, brother.
Soldier Yashar.
Soldier Yashar.
Mm-hmm. Oh, it's the Bible.
The table is the Bible. Okay, come on.
That he may run that readeth it.
Mm-hmm.
For the vision is yet for an appointed time.
For the vision is yet for an appointed time. Because the times when our forefathers was prophesying about Babylon, you had Jeremiah, Isaiah, Habakkuk, you had different people that spoke about Babylon, America was not in existence yet. Okay, go ahead.
But at the end it shall speak.
But at the end it shall speak, meaning at the end it shall come to pass. Go ahead.
And not lie.
And not lie, come on.
Though it tarry, wait for it.
Though it didn't happen yet, wait for it, come on.
Because it will surely come. It will not tarry.
Because it will surely come to pass, it will not tarry. It will not tarry. Give me 1 Corinthians 13 and verse 8.
1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 8. Mm-hmm. Charity never faileth.
So charity never faileth. Come on.
But whether there be prophecies, they shall fail.
So what is that talking about? Because when we read Habakkuk chapter 2, it says that it shall come to pass and it shall not lie. Now when we read 1 Corinthians 13 and 8, it says, but prophecies shall fail. What is that talking about? What is that talking about? Officer Yerakamil. What is that making reference to? Is there a contradiction in the Bible?
No, sir. It's talking about the prophecies of man.
The what?
Prophecies of man.
No. Azan. Officer Azan, what is that talking about? 1 Corinthians 13 and 8.
Charity never faileth, but whether there be prophecies, they shall fail.
You read it again, I'm sorry.
But whether there be prophecies, they shall fail.
Well, the prophecies will not fail. The scriptures say the prophecies shall not fail. So it's talking about they. The question is, who's the they?
No, that's not what I asked you. I said, what is that talking about? What is the prophecy talking about? Somebody help him. Somebody help him. Milkema, again. Let's try you again.
I really don't have a direct answer, okay. But the prophecies of Esau?
No. Did the prophecies of Esau fail? Think, brothers. Thy set thy nest amongst the stars. Did that fail? So what is that fail going into? What is it really talking about?
It's saying that the prophecy is going to come to pass.
It's going to come to pass. There's a start and an end period. That's all it's talking about. That's all it's making reference to. Y'all understand? I want to make sure y'all not confused. Go read that again. 1 Corinthians 13 and 8.
Charity never faileth.
Mm-hmm.
But whether there be prophecies, they shall fail.
Meaning there's a stop point. There's a start and an end. Okay? Now let's go to Bel and the Dragon. Since we're dealing with Babylon. Modern day Babylon. America. Babylon the Great is America. Let's go to Bel and the Dragon. Let's start at verse 33. This is a book we don't normally bring out all the time, but y'all should get familiar with it. It's in the Apocrypha.
History of Bel and the Dragon in the Apocrypha, verse 33. Now there was in Jewry a prophet called Habakkuk, who had made pottage and had broken bread in a bowl and was going into the field for to bring it to the reapers. But the angel of the Lord said unto Habakkuk, go. Carry the dinner that thou hast into Babylon unto Daniel,
mm-hmm.
who is in the lion's den.
So Habakkuk was commanded to go into the lion's den and give this dinner to Daniel. Go ahead.
And Habakkuk said, Lord, I never saw Babylon,
mm-hmm.
neither do I know where the den is. Then the angel of the Lord took him by the crown.
Mm-hmm. And this is talking about a chariot right here. Took him by the crown. Come on.
And bare him by the hair of his head. And through the vehemency of his spirit, set him in Babylon over the den.
Go ahead.
And Habakkuk cried, saying, O Daniel, Daniel, take the dinner which God hath sent thee.
Mm-hmm.
And Daniel said, Thou hast remembered me, O God, mm-hmm. neither hast thou forsaken them that seek thee and love thee.
Because mm-hmm. Daniel had a lot of faith. Daniel had a lot of faith, and the Most High God was working with Daniel. When he was thrown into the furnace and when he was thrown into the den. All right? Daniel was on another level. Go ahead.
So Daniel arose and did eat. And the angel of the Lord set Habakkuk in his own place again immediately.
And the chariot took him right back to where Habakkuk was originally. Go ahead.
Upon the seventh day, the king went to bewail Daniel.
Mm-hmm.
And when he came to the den, he looked in, and behold, Daniel was sitting. Then cried the king with a loud voice, saying, Great art thou, O Lord God of Daniel, and there is none other beside thee. And he drew him out and cast those that were the cause of his destruction into the den, and they were devoured in a moment before his face.
Now get me Daniel 6. Daniel 6. Let's read about that. Daniel the 6th chapter. Daniel the 6th chapter. Start at verse 1.
Daniel chapter 6, verse 1. It pleased Darius to set over the kingdom 120 princes, which should be over the whole kingdom. And over these three presidents, of whom Daniel was first, that the princes might give accounts unto them, and the king should have no damage. Then this Daniel was preferred above the presidents and princes, because an excellent spirit was in him.
Who's this Darius, by the way? Who is this Darius? Officer Yerachamel. Who is he the king of?
I believe he's the king of the Medes.
He was the king of who?
The Medes.
Very good. Very good. Okay, go ahead. And he conquered who? Who did the Medes conquer? How did he get in contact with Daniel? Who did the Medes conquer?
I'm not sure how he got.
You gotta read up on your history. Was it Alexander the Great? Who did Darius conquer? Was it Shaka Zulu?
No, sir.
Was it George Washington? So who did he conquer? Somebody tell me. Officer Zahn.
Babylon.
Conquered Babylon. And what king did he conquer in Babylon? Officer Zahn.
Nebuchadnezzar?
No. Y'all now reading y'all history. Y'all got all the time in the world since Most people are working from home to study. Now's the time to open it. All you got to do is jump to the chapter before, brothers. Jump to the chapter before, around the last couple of verses. Azan, you read verse 29 to 31, chapter 5. Daniel 5, 29 to 31.
Daniel chapter 5, verse 29?
29.
Verse 29. Then commanded Belshazzar.
Commanded who?
Belshazzar.
Go ahead.
And they clothed Daniel with scarlet and put a chain of gold around his neck and made a proclamation concerning him that he should be the third ruler in the kingdom.
Go ahead.
And the night was Belshazzar, the king of Chaldeans, slain.
Uh-huh.
And Darius the Median took the kingdom, being around 62 years old.
So who did Darius conquer?
Belshazzar.
Belshazzar. Okay, when y'all get a chance, go over and read. Do you, you should be doing your four chapters a day. Go over the history. Okay, go back to Daniel 6. Officer Lemuel.
Daniel chapter 6, verse 3. Then this Daniel was preferred above the presidents and princes because an excellent spirit was in him, and the king thought to set him over the whole realm.
So Daniel was set over the whole realm by Darius, right? He was preferred above the presidents and princes. Go ahead.
Verse 4. Mm-hmm. Then the presidents and princes sought to find occasion against Daniel concerning the kingdom, but they could find none occasion nor fault. For as much as he was faithful, neither was there any error or fault found in him.
So this is how we got to walk in modern day Babylon. We got to walk the same way, being found without fault or error and remain faithful. Go ahead.
Then said these men, we shall not find any occasion against this Daniel, except we find it against him concerning the law of his God. Then these presidents and princes assembled together to the king and said thus unto him, King Darius, live forever. All the presidents of the kingdom, the governors and the princes, the counselors and the captains have consulted together to establish a royal statute and to make a firm decree that whosoever shall ask a petition of any god or man for 30 days, save of thee, O king, he shall be cast into the den of lions.
Go ahead.
Now, O king, establish the decree and sign the writing, that it be not changed according to the law of the Medes and Persians, which altereth not. Wherefore King Darius signed the writing and the decree. Now when Daniel knew that the writing was signed, he went into his house, and his windows being open in his chamber.
Now remember, these brothers that did this, that caused the king to pass this new proclamation, it was all a plot against Daniel. It was all a plot against Daniel. Go ahead.
And his windows being open in his chamber toward Jerusalem, he kneeled upon his knees 3 times a day and prayed and gave thanks before his God, as he did aforetime.
And we should do the same thing. Pray without, pardon, pray without ceasing. Go ahead.
Then these men assembled and found Daniel praying and making supplication before his God. Then they came near and spake before the king concerning the decree, the king's decree. Hast thou not signed a decree that every man that shall ask a petition of any god or man within 30 days, save of thee, O king, shall be cast into the den of lions? The king answered and said, the thing is true, according to the law of the Medes and Persians, which altereth not.
Which changeth not. Go ahead.
Then answered they and said before the king, that Daniel, which is of the children of the captivity of Judah, regardeth not thee, O king, nor the decree that thou hast signed, but maketh his petition 3 times a day.
See, right there, they called him out. Right? All of this was put into place to what? Call out Daniel. Find a fault in him because he was blameless. Go ahead.
Then the king, when he heard these words, was sore displeased with himself and set his heart on Daniel to deliver him, and he labored till the going down of the sun to deliver him. Then these men assembled unto the king and said unto the king, know, O king, that the law of the Medes and Persians is that no decree nor statutes which the king establisheth may be changed.
Come on.
Then the king commanded, and they brought Daniel and cast him into the den of lions.
So they cast Daniel into the den of lions. This is the same den of lions that Habakkuk went into. Go ahead.
Now the king spake and said unto Daniel, thy God whom thou servest continually, he will deliver thee. And a stone was brought and laid upon the mouth of the den. And the king sealed it with his own signet and with the signet of his lords, that the purpose might not be changed concerning Daniel.
Mm-hmm.
Then the king went to his palace and passed the night fasting. Neither were instruments of music brought before him, and his sleep went from him. Then the king arose very early in the morning and went in haste unto the den of lions. And when he came to the den, he cried with a lamentable voice unto Daniel. And the king spake and said to Daniel, O Daniel, servant of the Lord God, is thy God whom thou servest continually able to deliver thee from the lions?
Go ahead.
Then said Daniel unto the king, O king, live forever.
Come on.
My God had sent his angel.
Now, when it says, O king, live forever, that's flattery right there. Okay? That's all flattery. That was the same thing Paul was doing with Agrippa. Okay? Come on.
My God had sent his angel.
My God had sent his angel. What kind of angel did God send? Hold that. Give me 2 Maccabees 11, verse 6. 2 Maccabees 11, verse 6. Some beautiful history right here we're reading with our forefather Daniel. Y'all should be familiar with this. Daniel is not a big book. It's a small book. When y'all get a chance, go over the history. And we have classes on some of these breakdowns and for some of these chapters. Go ahead.
2 Maccabees chapter 11, verse 6. Now when they that were with Maccabeus heard that he besieged the holds, they and all the people with lamentation and tears besought the Lord that he would send a good angel.
Send a what?
A good angel.
So you have good angels and you have bad angels. Okay, now go back to Daniel 7.
Daniel chapter 6, verse
22.
My God had sent his angel.
The same angel was the same angel. The same angel that took who? Took Habakkuk and brought him over there to Daniel. Go ahead.
And had shut the lion's mouth that they have not hurt me. For as much as before him innocency was found in me, and also before thee, O king, have I done no hurt.
All praises. Now jump to chapter 7. Chapter 7. We're still talking about Babylon. Chapter 7, we're going to read 1 through 8.
Daniel chapter 7, verse 1. In the first year of Belshazzar, king of Babylon, Daniel had a dream and visions of his head upon his bed.
Now, notice is jumping from time to time, because we read that Darius in chapter 6. Darius, at the end of chapter 5, around the 29th verse on down, Belshazzar was conquered. Darius came. Now we're in chapter 7, and it's talking about Belshazzar again. It's going back and forth. All right, y'all understand? So you're not confused, okay? Go ahead, come on.
In the first year of Belshazzar, king of Babylon, Daniel had a dream and visions of his head upon his bed. Then he wrote the dream and told the sum of the matters. Daniel spake and said, I saw in my vision by night, and behold, the four winds of the heaven strove upon the great sea. And four great beasts came up from the sea, diverse one from another. The first was like a lion and had eagle's wings.
Who's that talking about? We went over this. All right, we're not going to spend too much time on this. We're going to breeze right through this. All right, Officer Yerachamel, who is the lion that had eagle's wings?
Sir, that would be Babylon.
Babylon, very good. Go ahead.
And had eagle's wings. I beheld till the wings thereof were plucked, and it was lifted up from the earth, and made stand upon the feet as a man. And a man's heart was given to it. And behold, another beast, a second like to a bear. And it raised up itself on the side.
What is this going into? Who is this other beast that was like unto a bear?
The second beast was the Medes and Persians.
The Medes and the Persians, very good. And the Medes came first. That's why I said the bear rose up on one side. Okay, go ahead.
It had three ribs in the mouth of it between the teeth of it. And they said thus unto it, arise, devour much flesh.
Mm-hmm.
After this I beheld, and lo, another, like a leopard.
Who's the leopard? Who is the leopard, Officer Azan?
It's the Greeks.
The Greeks, very good. Go ahead.
Which had upon the back of it four wings of a fowl. The beast had also four heads, and dominion was given to it.
Those are the generals that came up with Alexander the Great. Go ahead.
After this I saw in the night visions, and behold, a fourth beast, dreadful and terrible, and strong exceedingly. And it had great iron teeth. It devoured and brake in pieces, and stamped the residue with the feet of it. And it was diverse one from all the beasts that were before it. and it had 10 horns.
What beast is this talking about in verse 7? What beast is this talking about, Officer Emmanuel? Daniel chapter 7 and verse 7. What beast is this talking about?
He's talking about Rome. You're going to read about it in 2 Ezra 11?
Okay, very good. It's talking about Rome. Very good. Go ahead.
Verse 8. I considered the horns, and behold, there came up among them another little horn, before whom there were three of the first horns, plucked up by the roots.
What is that making reference to? We went over this already. And earlier, I believe Officer Liam was touching on Daniel 7. We went over this. What is this talking about? Even in the video that we started off with from Vox, talking about America's history, they touched on it a bit. Soldier, right here in the front.
On three horns, Spain, France, and Britain.
And who?
And Britain.
And you said Greek?
No, Britain.
Britain, France, very Spain, good. France, and Britain. Very good. All right, let's show that. Because those were the colonies that were here. And then America came out of who? Britain. America came out of Britain. Okay, that's what Daniel chapter 7, verse 8 is going into. Let's show this, please. Blow it up nice and big. Y'all see this? Read it again. Leave that up there on the screen and read Daniel 7, verse 8 again.
I considered the horns, and behold, there came up among them another little horn, before whom there were three of the first horns plucked up by the roots. And behold, in this horn were eyes like the eyes of man, and a mouth speaking great things.
And a mouth speaking great things. And those great things were blasphemies, blasphemy, lies, okay, from the devil himself, Esau. So right here you have the colonies, okay? You had Spain, you have France, and you have Great Britain. And we all know that America comes out of Great Britain, okay? So you had an armed conflict that began in 1775. So what year was America's independence? 1776. It started in 1775 and reached its peak in 1776. In 1776, the Second Continental Congress declared its independence. That was 1776. And around that time, there was a lot of things going on. Where were the so-called Negroes at that time? 1776. Where were the tribe of Gad, the natives? Where were they? Slavery as well. All right, Jeremiah 50, verse 33. Jeremiah chapter 50, verse 33.
Jeremiah chapter 50, verse 33. Thus saith the Lord of hosts, the children of Israel and the children of Judah were oppressed together.
So God lets us know that the children of Judah and the children of Israel were oppressed together. Okay, blacks and native Indians were oppressed together. Okay, we suffered affliction together, tribulation, slavery, everything you could think of that happened to the so-called black man. Guess what? It happened to the natives as well. Okay? Now, so while this was going on with 1776, who was the colonies? Who were they fighting? They were fighting themselves, right? It was basically Esau against Esau, correct? For their freedom. Give me Isaiah 19 and verse 2.
Isaiah chapter 19, verse 2.
Come on.
And I will set the Egyptians against the Egyptians.
Who were the Egyptians? What does God compare Egypt to? Soldier, in the front. What does God compare Egypt to? Right here, in the front.
Let me pay Egypt to America.
Okay, what else?
Compared to...
What does the Bible say Egypt is?
Oh, the house of bondage.
The house of bondage, the oppressor, the house of bondage. Okay, read Isaiah 19, verse 2 again.
And I will set the Egyptians against the Egyptians.
So God said, I'm going to set the oppressors against the oppressors, because that's what Egypt was synonymous for, oppression, bondage. Okay, So that whole thing that happened in 1776, the Most High was behind all of that. The Most High had Esau fighting Esau. Okay, go ahead.
And they shall fight everyone against his brother.
Go ahead.
And everyone against his neighbor.
Mm-hmm.
City against city and kingdom against kingdom. And the spirit of Egypt shall fail in the midst thereof. And I will destroy the counsel thereof. And they shall seek to the idols and to the charmers and to them that have familiar spirits and to the wizards.
Hmm. So it says, and they shall seek to the idols and to the charmers and to them that have familiar spirits and to the wizards. This was all happening around the time of 1776. What you're going to find out today, that not only is America Babylon the Great, these people are the devil that the Bible speaks of. Everything around you is built on sorcery and witchcraft. We're going to go into that more today. Okay, but before we do, before we move on, get me the town destroyer on Wikipedia. I think I sent that to you, Jonathan. You should have it. George Washington.
Town destroyer, not to be confused with town class destroyer. Thank you. Connotacarius was a nickname given to George Washington by Iroquois Native Americans in 1753. The name in its original language or languages has been given variously as Connotacarius. It has also been translated as town taker, burner of towns, devourer of villages, or he destroys the town.
So this was George Washington's nickname. Everything started off on bloodshed. It was no peace, okay? George Washington, the devil, the Edomite, this is how they took America, okay? So you had the Iroquois Native Americans, GAD, that's the nickname that they gave to George Washington, right? Now, we also read in Isaiah 19, verse 2, where it said, and they shall seek to the idols and to the charmers and to them that have familiar spirits and to the wizards. Get me that, please. So not only was this man, because George Washington, when you read the history, brothers, George Washington was a Mason. And many of his colleagues were Masons, Freemasons. Okay, get me the next article. You know what I want. Yes. Okay, so this is in the Capitol. This is in the Capitol in Washington, D.C. Y'all get a good view of that? Y'all can see that? That's George Washington right there, right? Freemason. Now, what does that look familiar with? The who? The Baphomet. Very good. Let's show that picture. Witchcraft. They used witchcraft in Babylon, ancient Babylon. Guess what? They use witchcraft today. Okay, it's the same thing. It's the same thing. The way he got his hands positioned and everything. It was modeled, that picture, that image that you see was modeled after the Baphomet. Now get me what I sent you on George Washington. The George Washington Masonic Memorial Freemasons White House Stones Exhibit. Go ahead, Lemuel. Let's start it off. All right, we're gonna bounce around. We're not going to read the whole thing. I just want to show you how George Washington was a Freemason. And many of the so-called founding fathers of America. We know that the real founding fathers was the tribe of Gad, okay? But Esau, he calls himself the founding fathers. Many of them were Freemasons. Many of them were into idolatry, witchcraft, and a whole bunch of nonsense. Go ahead.
The George Washington Masonic Memorial opened a new exhibit in February featuring 45 historic White House stones. Each stone is marked by a Scottish stonesman who helped build the White House. The stones are reassembled for the first time since President Harry S. Truman sent one to every United States Masonic Grand Lodge in 1952.
There's the proof right there. All right, Harry Truman, another devil, he sent one to every United States Masonic Grand Lodge in 1952. Go ahead.
Complimenting the stones is a minute book from the Lodge of Journeyman Masons number 8 of Edinburgh, Scotland. It lists members of the lodge who, in 1794, immigrated to help build the White House. Accompanying the book is the lodge's mark book, showing each stonesman's trademark. By comparing these marks to the marks on the stones, visitors may identify the men who helped to build the president's house. The exhibit opened in conjunction with the Memorial Association's 100th anniversary, and will run through May 2011.
Go down. Go ahead.
In 1789, President George Washington and the United States Congress were determined to build a great capital city. By 1792, the site was chosen. Designer Pierre L'Enfant's street plan was adopted and work began. At the city center would be the United States Capitol, the People's House. The President's House would be located on Pennsylvania Avenue. Washington reviewed the site and personally selected architect James Hoban's design.
So you have the United States Capitol, and then you have the President's House, the White House, what they call, on Pennsylvania Avenue. Go ahead.
The mansion's cornerstone was laid with a small civic and Masonic ceremony on October 13, 1792.
Down.
Although foundation work then began in earnest, the government soon discovered that the young nation had an abundance of craftsmen, but few master stone masons. What's more, those it did have were working on the United States Capitol. After a thorough search in America and Europe, Agent George Walker traveled to Edinburgh, Scotland. By spring 1794, he had recruited at least 8 stonesmen from the Lodge of Journeyman Masons. The Lodge of Journeyman Masons, number 8.
Down.
Go ahead.
With the arrival of the 8 Scots stonesmen, the White House walls rose to completion in 1798. During construction, the stonemasons, being Freemasons, joined the local lodge.
So that those words were interchangeable, okay? Go ahead. Stonemason, Freemason. Go ahead.
Federal Lodge number 15 had been chartered September 12, 1793, by the Grand Lodge of Maryland. James Hoban was its first worshipful master. Federal Lodge became the first lodge when the Grand Lodge of the District of Columbia was constituted in 1811. The exhibit also includes Federal Lodge's first account book listing the Scots stonemasons and White House architect James Hoban as its first master. Additional materials include a letter from President Truman, historic photographs, and other items.
Last paragraph.
The White House stones were discovered soon after Truman became president in 1945. With major plaster cracks appearing and a piano dropping nearly through the floor, it was obvious that the executive mansion needed a complete overhaul. The first family relocated to Blair House as work began.
All right, stop there. Get me Micah 2. We're going to read 1 to 2. All right, so not only was George Washington a Freemason, his constituents were, his colleagues were, okay? And they destroyed many villages of the tribe of Gad. And not only that, who do you think built the White House? Brothers, who built the White House? Our people, slaves, Negroes, black people. Okay, Micah chapter 2, 1 to 2.
Micah chapter 2, verse 1. Woe to them that devise iniquity and work evil upon their beds.
Go ahead.
When the morning is light, they practice.
And we're about to get into that a little soon. We're going to show you all the evils. You thought that statue was bad with Baphomet. There's a whole lot more. Go ahead.
Because it is in the power of their hand.
Mm-hmm.
And they covet fields and take them by violence.
They covet what?
They covet fields and take them by violence.
That's why he was called a town destroyer. Okay, they covet fields and they take it by violence. Is that it on verse 2?
No, sir.
Go ahead.
And houses and take them away. So they oppress a man and his house, even a man and his heritage.
So they oppress a man and his house, even a man and his heritage. Is that all? Yes, sir. Get me Habakkuk chapter 2 and verse 4. Right? So we're going to go into the depths of Satan and show you beyond a reasonable doubt that this is Babylon and how America got started. America got started off in idolatry, witchcraft, sorcery. All right? We just seen the image of George Washington looking just like the Baphomet. And guess what? There's more. Go ahead. Habakkuk chapter 2, verse 4.
Behold, his soul which is lifted up is not upright in him. But the just shall live by his faith.
You hear that? It says the soul in Esau is not upright. It's not upright in him. This white man, this Edomite, his soul is not right. But guess what? That's how God made him. And many of you think that you can change him. Some of you have friends, ex-girlfriends, that some of you probably still keep in contact with. You still idolize everything that Esau says, okay? If an Israelite says it, nah, doesn't matter. But if a white man says it, oh, yes, they're right because they're white, okay? Go ahead. Read verse it again, Habakkuk 2, verse 4. Come on.
Behold, his soul which is lifted up is not upright in him, but the just shall live by his faith.
Now get me Ezekiel. I want Ezekiel chapter 1 and verse 1. Ezekiel was another forefather who spoke about Babylon. Was he speaking about ancient Babylon in some verses? Yes. Was he prophesying about this Babylon today? Absolutely. Okay, go ahead.
Ezekiel chapter 1, verse 1. Now it came to pass in the 30th year, in the fourth month, in the fifth day of the month, as I was among the captives by the river of Chebar, that the heavens were opened and I saw visions of God.
So where was Ezekiel? He was by the rivers of Sheber, which was in Babylon. Is that it on verse 1 or there's more? Okay, now get me, I want Psalms 137 and verse 7. Psalms 137 and verse 7.
Psalms chapter 137 and verse 7. Remember, O Lord, the children of Edom in the day of Jerusalem, who said, race it. Race it, even to the foundation thereof.
So who's the topic? The children of Edom. Who's the children of Edom? This so-called Caucasian man, so-called white man. Go ahead.
Verse 8. O daughter of Babylon.
O who?
O daughter of Babylon.
O daughter of Babylon. Daughter of Babylon. Go ahead.
Who ought to be destroyed.
Who ought to be destroyed. That's the future prophecy of Esau. They will be destroyed. God calls him the daughter of Babylon. Now, go to Ezekiel, chapter 21 and verse 21. Ezekiel, chapter 21 and verse 21.
Ezekiel, chapter 21, verse 21. For the king of Babylon stood at the parting of the way, at the head of the two ways, to use divination.
So the king of Babylon, we just read about one king, because the president is considered a king, although this is not a monarchy, right? You had George Washington. He was a Freemason, right? Many of the presidents after him were Freemasons. Same thing. Read it again. Read it again. Let's hear what Ezekiel's saying. Go ahead.
For the king of Babylon stood at the parting of the way, at the head of the two ways, to use divination.
To use divination. Come on.
He made his arrows bright.
Uh-huh.
He consulted with images. He looked in the liver.
He consulted with images and he looked in the liver. The liver was used as a, back then, the Babylonians were using different parts of animals for witchcraft, for witchcraft, for witchcraft. Go back to Isaiah 19 and 2. Let's prove that some more. Isaiah 19 and 2 again.
Isaiah chapter 19, verse 2.
Just in case y'all forgot. Go ahead.
And I will set the Egyptians against the Egyptians.
Jump to verse 3. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Verse 3. And the spirit of Egypt shall fail in the midst thereof, and I will destroy the counsel thereof. And they shall seek to the idols, and to the charmers, and to them that have familiar spirits.
So all the children of Ham were doing the same thing. They were into idols, they were charmers, and seeking to familiar spirits, and to what?
And to the wizards.
And to the wizards. Go back to Ezekiel now. Let's go to the brother of Egypt, which was Cush.
Ezekiel.
All right, also known as Babylon. Go ahead.
Ezekiel 21, 21.
Go ahead.
For the king of Babylon stood at the parting of the way, at the head of the two ways, to use divination. He made his arrows bright. He consulted with images.
He consulted with images. Go ahead.
He looked in the liver.
He looked in the liver. All witchcraft. All witchcraft. Now let's go into the daughter of Babylon. Okay, because this was speaking about ancient Babylon, but it was also prophetic about Esau, the daughter of Babylon. Get me the U.S. dollar that I sent you. Okay, because we've seen the Baphomet. We've seen the George Washington monument, right? Let's get the dollar, the back of the dollar. All right, what do you have here? Somebody describe. What are we looking at? What are we looking at? Officer Urakamel. Keep in mind what we're talking about, right? Divination, witchcraft, things that were in ancient Babylon, Egypt, and now.
We have a pyramid.
Pyramid, okay. Where can a pyramid be found? Ancient Egypt. What is the pyramid being doing on the back of a U.S. dollar. Why? Because it's the same thing, same witchcraft, same ideologies and so forth. So you have the pyramid. What else do you have?
Got the eagle.
You got the eagle. Okay, we know what that is, right? Although thou exalt thyself as the eagle, right? What else do we have?
Got the eye.
The all-seeing eye of what?
Ra.
Of Ra. Okay, you said it like you was in doubt. You got to be more confident than that. Yes, that is the all-seeing eye of Ra. Where do we get that from? Ancient Egyptology. Okay, what else do we have?
Got stars.
Okay, and what is the stars in shape of?
Like the five-point.
The pentagram.
Pentagram.
Yes, stars in the shape of a pentagram. Keep that in mind. All right, then you have the eagle. How many arrows is in the eagle's hand? 13 represent for who? The what? Okay, that's what Esau tells you, right? The 13 colonies, right? You have the disciples and you have Christ. The eagle is a prey, is a what? A bird of prey that conquers. That conquers. Some of you ain't going to get this. Some of you, y'all, I'm telling you, y'all just go with wholeheartedly whatever Esau says. Okay? Come with arrow in one hand, and they got what? The olive branch in the other. Peace. Okay, we're going to read about that too. Come with peace with one hand, but the other hand, you got a whole bunch of arrows. What? Weapons of war. Okay, in representation of the 12 and Christ. Now flip the dollar around. Flip it around. Let's go to what I sent you, the other dollar. Okay, now when you turn the dollar around, what is that, brothers? What do you see on the front?
Owl.
A what?
Owl.
You see an owl. What is an owl? You ever ask yourself, what is the owl doing on the dollar? Some of you got dollars in your pocket right now. I challenge you, take it out if you think we're making this up. They say the Israelites is conspiracy theories. All right. Your brain is a conspiracy. Okay? So you have an owl on the dollar. Why? Why was it there? Why not an elephant? Why an owl? Why a pyramid with an eye inside of the damn pyramid, the all-seeing eye of Ra? Why? You never ask yourself these things because you take things wholeheartedly. Get me the next thing. What do you have here? You have the Washington, D.C. Capitol Hill, right? You have the Washington Monument. You have also what's called the White House, and there's something else that I'm missing. But they're all in shape of, what is that? What does that look like to y'all when you connect the points? A what? An owl. What is that? Anybody familiar with this? Huh? That's who? Somebody said it. What god is that? Huh? Molech. That is the god of Molech, which is in the scriptures, which is in the Bible. We're going to read it soon. Okay? And then on top of that, you have the owl. You have the god Molech, and you have the owl. Let's get Isaiah 47 and verse 1 real quick. Hold that. We're going to get Isaiah 47 and verse 1.
Isaiah chapter 47, verse 1. Come down and sit in the dust, O daughter, O virgin daughter of Babylon.
O virgin daughter of Babylon. This is making reference to America. This is making reference to America. America. Go ahead.
Sit on the ground. There is no throne, O daughter of the Chaldeans, for thou shalt no more be called tender and delicate.
This is talking about when the destruction comes. Go ahead.
Take the millstones and grind meal.
Jump to verse 9.
Verse 9. But these two things shall come to thee in a moment, in one day.
Mm-hmm.
The loss of children and widowhood.
That's talking about destruction. Go ahead.
They shall come upon thee in their perfection.
Mm-hmm.
For the multitude of
thy... The reason... God is giving you the reason why this destruction is going to happen. Go ahead.
They shall come upon thee in their perfection for the multitude of thy sorcery.
For the multitude of thy sorcery. Not just one. Multiple examples of sorcery being used in America's inception. We've seen the statue of George Washington, right? Mimicking the Baphomet. Now, when you examine the U.S. dollar, the U.S. currency, what do you see? You see the pyramids. You see the all-seeing eye of Ra. You see the owl that a lot of people never seen before. Some of you brothers probably never seen that. This is probably your first time even noticing that. Okay, that's how much things are just put in our faces and we don't even realize that it's there or what it means, the significance of these things. Read that last part again. For the multitude.
For the multitude of thy sorceries and for the great abundance of thine enchantments.
Hear what God is telling us? For the great abundance of thine enchantments. Read verse 10.
For thou hast trusted in thy wickedness.
For thou hast trusted in thy wickedness. Come on.
Thou hast said, none seeth me.
He's the one that's saying, who seeth me? He's the one. All of this, all of these evils that Esau has done is coming to pass. It's coming out now. God is revealing everything now to who? To the prophets, so we could bring it out to you and make the Bible more real, more plain to you. Read that verse again.
For thou hast trusted in thy wickedness.
Mm-hmm.
Thou hast said, none seeth me.
Come on.
Thy wisdom and thy knowledge,
mm-hmm.
it hath perverted thee.
So your wisdom and your knowledge has perverted you. That's why it says the pride of thine heart. Who's it making reference to? Esau. Esau is the one that's proud. It says your wisdom and your knowledge hath perverted thee. Go ahead.
And thou hast said in thine heart, I am, and none else beside me.
Esau is the one that says, I am. Who's the I am? It's talking about God. Esau is the one that says, I am, okay, that sitteth in the temple of God, posing as God, speaking blasphemies. Read that last part where it says, and thou hast said.
And thou hast said in thine heart, I am, mm-hmm. and none else beside me.
Read, jump down to verse 12.
Verse 12. Stand now. You're
reading 12 to 13.
Stand now with thine enchantments.
God is telling you now, stand with your enchantments. Come on. The same enchantments that you had from the beginning. Go ahead.
And with the multitude of thy sorceries.
Go ahead.
Wherein thou hast labored from thy youth.
Wherein thou hast labored from thy youth. What is that? What was America's youth? What year was America's youth? We just went over it. What year was America's youth?
1776.
That's when all this witchcraft was going on. Okay, go ahead.
If so be thou shalt be able to profit, if so be thou mayest prevail.
Go ahead.
Thou art wearied in the multitude of thy counsels.
Go ahead.
Let now the astrologers,
go ahead.
The stargazers,
come on.
The monthly prognosticators.
Go ahead.
Stand up and save thee from these things that shall come upon thee.
And God is saying, okay, let these people save you from my wrath, from those ICBMs that's soon to come during World War III. Let the enchantment save you. Let the astrologers, the stargazers, everybody that helped you prosper with your witchcraft, let them save you. Okay, that's what God is saying here in that verse. Read it one more time. Read it again. Verse 13.
Thou art wearied in the multitude of thy counsels. Let now the astrologers, the stargazers, the monthly prognosticators stand up and save thee from these things that shall come upon thee.
Beautiful. Now, let's move on. We have the Bohemian owl right there, right? And we have the Moloch. Go forward. Next picture. Okay, that's more proof of how the United States of America, Washington, D.C., you have the Pentagon. That's what I forgot. The Pentagon, Washington, the monument. You have the state capitol, and you have the White House. How if you connect everything together, it comes out as a pentagram. These are the Freemasons that built D.C. just like this. Why? In honor of who? In honor of the devil, who they serve, their God. Okay, go ahead. That's the points connecting, all right? There you have the state capital, just like ancient Greece, ancient Rome, which ancient Rome and ancient Greece is patterned after ancient Egypt. This is where they get all of their architecture from, all of their ideologies from. Okay, go ahead. So on the side of the U.S. Capitol building, you have this right here, the pagan god Mars. What is the pagan god Mars doing on the side of the United States Capitol building? It's all witchcraft. It's all divination. Go ahead. Zoom in. See? And you see the replica. You see how they all look the same. So you have the White House on the top. You have the Jefferson Memorial, right? Modeled after the pagan Roman pantheon. You have the Lincoln Memorial, modeled after the pagan Greek pantheon. Then you have the second bank of the United States. Notice the pillars. Notice how they all look the same. Look how they all look the same. Go ahead. Go to the next picture. Okay, so this right here is a real place. We're about to read about it, okay? This right here is a real place. It's called the Bohemian Grove. How many of you brothers heard of the Bohemian Grove? Y'all heard about it. Somebody explain it. Somebody explain what you heard. Brother right there, you. Yes, sir. Somebody explain. Give him the mic. Somebody explain to me. Explain.
Shalom, Brother Matthew. I just heard that that's where all the presidents and 1% and leaders, they get together and they do all kind of pagan rituals. Heard molestation, sacrifices, things like that.
Okay. Okay. Good. So y'all on point. I thought some of y'all was sleeping. Get me the, you skipped something, Jonathan. Get me the Statue of Freedom. Lady Liberty.
Statue of Freedom. The Statue of Freedom, also known as Ahmed Freedom or simply Freedom, is a bronze statue designed by Thomas Crawford that, since 1863, has crowned the dome of the U.S. Capitol building in Washington, D.C., originally named Freedom Triumphant in War and Peace.
So it said that this crowned the dome of the U.S. Capitol building in Washington, D.C. Go ahead. Originally named what?
Originally named Freedom Triumphant in War and Peace.
Mm-hmm.
A U.S. government publication now states that the statue is officially known as the Statue of Freedom.
Go ahead. Freedom for whom? Not for us, because we was in captivity. Go ahead.
The statue depicts a female figure bearing a military helmet and holding a sheathed sword in her right hand and a laurel wreath and shield in her left.
Okay, so you have this Statue of Freedom, Lady Liberty, and also you have the how do you call that thing? The Statue of Liberty over there in the Hudson in New York. Okay, get me Isaiah 47 and verse 7.
Isaiah.
So everything is all witchcraft, man. America was founded on witchcraft. Go ahead.
Isaiah 47 and 7. And thou sayest.
And thou saidest. Come on.
I shall be a lady.
Go ahead.
Forever.
That's why in the beginning I said, take notice of that woman in that video. Okay, they always portray America as a what? As a woman. All right, she's that same well-favored harlot. The Most High's word don't go out and come back void, y'all. Okay? Everything that the Most High say is going to come to pass. Okay? The Most High will is going to be done, whether it's good or evil. The Most High said, look, she's going to be called a well-favored harlot. He's going to make sure that this man is pushing those kind of imageries out there. Okay? There's a reason. There's a reason why this man is operating the way he is, because everything is orchestrated by the Most High God. Okay? Read that again. Isaiah 47, verse 7. Go ahead.
And thou sayest, I shall be a lady forever,
mm-hmm.
so that thou didst not lay these things to thy heart,
uh-huh.
neither didst remember the latter end of it.
Go ahead.
Therefore, hear now this, thou that art given to pleasures.
Just stop right there. Stop. Verse 7 was enough. Give me Revelation 17, verse 4.
Revelation chapter 17, verse 4. Mm-hmm. And the woman was arrayed in purple and scarlet color.
And the woman was arrayed in purple color and scarlet color. I said that right?
Purple and scarlet color,
go
yes,
ahead.
Sir. And decked with gold and precious stones and pearls,
mm-hmm.
having a golden cup in her hand,
mm-hmm.
full of abominations and filthiness of her fornication.
Full of abominations and filthiness of her fornication. What we're seeing here is spiritual fornication. Because there ain't no pagan Mars god. Okay, there's no Moloch, all right? All of that stuff is not real, but they put it up as they serve it as it's a real God. And this is how they built America, on straight witchcraft and divination, okay? Go to, let's go back to the pictures. Okay, so there you have the Bohemian Grove, the owl. Go forward. Let's see what else we have. Let's go.
Skull and Bones is of the devil. Freemasonry is of the devil. nearly 2,000 carefully selected government officials, corporate tycoons, and other luminaries, men with power to shape the future, assemble privately every July in a redwood forest about 65 miles north of San Francisco. The meeting includes a somber ritual that features the druidic burning of an human effigy on the altar, chants from a roded chorus, and wild drinking and sexual promiscuity. Richard Nixon once famously described...
Richard Nixon, who was also a member of the Bohemian Grove, go ahead.
Once famously described the gathering as the most faggy G-damn thing you could ever imagine.
Mm-hmm.
The Bohemian Club, Bohos, as they are informally called, meet annually for a time of mixed business and pleasure, making decisions that will shape...
annually for a time of mixed business and pleasure. What do you think that pleasure was? Remember what Richard Nixon said. The most faggy G-damn thing you could ever imagine. Okay, the Bohemian Club, Bohos, synonymous with homos, all right, as they are informally called. Go ahead. Meet annually. Go ahead, Lemuel.
For a time of mixed business and pleasure,
mm-hmm.
making decisions that will shape our nation's future. While sinfully...
Make decisions that will shape our nation's future. Okay, when you read up the history, there's different books that talk about this. When you read into the history of this thing, they even said that the Manhattan Project was discussed here. Okay, with Albert Einstein, Oppenheimer, and the people behind him that was pulling the plugs. Okay, it says they meet annually for a time of mixed business and pleasure, making decisions that will shape our nation's future. And it's not talking about you. When it says our nations, they ain't talking about the so-called blacks, Hispanics, and natives. It's talking about Esau. Esau. Go ahead.
While sinfully indulging in homosexuality, cross-dressing, and debauchery.
Mm-hmm.
Please watch the video, The 124 Groups of Bohemian Grove, The United Nations and Atomic Bomb Were Birthed at Bohemian Grove.
That was the Manhattan Project that brought forth the atomic bomb. Okay, it says the United Nations and the atomic bomb were birthed at the Bohemian Grove. Go ahead.
The most bizarre pagan ritual of the Bohemian Grove, the cremation of care ceremony, is practiced by its members, all men,
mm-hmm.
including both Presidents Bush, Bill Clinton, Ronald Reagan, Alan Greenspan.
Alan Greenspan was one of the CEOs of the Federal Reserve at one time. Go ahead.
Richard M. Nixon,
mm-hmm.
Jimmy Carter, Walter Cronkite.
Walter who?
Walter Cronkite.
How many of y'all seen Friday Night Raw last night? You heard Deacon Asaf mention the name Walter Cronkite, right? He was a journalist. He was a broadcaster. Okay, guess what? They take part in this too. Why? Because that's the mouth of who? That's the mouth of the beast. That's the mouth of the beast. Guess what? They got to fall in line too. That's the only way America's going to push their agenda. That's the only way America's going to have popular persuasion over the masses to do what they want. All right? So some of the journalists, guess what? They got to take part in this too. Walter Cronkite. Okay? And we're going to talk about him a little later. Go ahead.
Colin Powell.
Up, Jigaboo. Come on.
And Henry Kissinger.
Henry Kissinger, the devil. Come on.
To name but a few.
Go ahead.
The meeting is held every July. It is purported that Obama and McCain visited Bohemian Grove in July of 2008.
Come on. You wanna run America? Guess what? You got to take part in America's witchcraft. You got to get down the same way the elite get down. You trying to sit at the table with them? Guess what? You have to sell your soul. Go ahead.
World leaders in the occult.
Mm-hmm.
No sitting U.S. president ever attends the Grove to avoid public scrutiny, as the president's every move is closely monitored by the media. Albeit, nearly every president attends the Grove before and after holding public office.
Go ahead.
Here's information on the Grove's financial records, who are registered as a 501c7,
mm-hmm.
nonprofit organization.
Go ahead.
Anyone who denies the satanic nature of Bohemian Grove is either stupid, woefully naive, or deliberately...
It says woefully, not willfully. It says woefully, meaning destruction unto your naive behind. Go ahead.
Woefully naive or deliberately complicit.
Mm-hmm.
Many celebrity stooges in the news media.
In the what?
In the news media.
Many celebrity stooges in the news media. Come on.
Like Bill O'Reilly, Sean Hannity, and Rush Limbaugh are gatekeepers.
Guess what? You have to add Walter Cronkite to that. Because remember, the bishop, I think it was 2 weeks ago, he did a class and he brought out the CFR. Many people didn't know what the CFR was, the Council on Foreign Relations, and how the CIA controls a lot of these different avenues. And one of them was the media. Guess what? Walter Cronkite, Bill O'Reilly, Rush Limbaugh, Sean Hannity, all these devils fall under that category. Okay, come on.
Influential people who protect the grove by ignoring and downplaying the...
How do you ignore and downplay something? You call it what? They call you what? Conspiracy nuts. Or a cult like us. We're saying we're the Israelites. We are God's chosen people. The whole world is looking at us. What? You niggas? Hell no. Them white people over there, the Israelites. Why? Because of news media, popular persuasion, witchcraft. Witchcraft. Holocaust. 6666 million. 6666. And guess what? One day we're going to get into that 6 million thing. Okay, I'm going to show you how that's all witchcraft. All an illusion. The more they speak it and speak it and speak it, the more you listen to it, you start to believe a lie. Right? Conspiracy theorists. Cult. It's black Hebrew Israelites. You start to believe it after a time of that constant programming. There's a reason why we could turn on the TV at 3 a.m., 4 a.m., 5 a.m., this constant what? Broadcasting. Broadcasting what? Esau's vision in your mind. Putting satellites in your head. Okay, so now you look at over there, you look at the Edomites over there in the land of Israel. Now they're the Jews and we're nothing. We're just spicks and niggas lost in the sauce. No, it shows you that the people in media, the news media, were gatekeepers. Okay, and their job is to what? Read that again. Influential people.
Influential people who protect the grove by ignoring and downplaying the satanic, perverse, and treasonous activities of the club.
Mm-hmm. Now, Officer Jonathan, get me, we skipped something. Get me the Wikipedia, wikipedia.org on Bohemian Grove. Let's get some more.
Bohemian Grove. Bohemian Grove is a restricted 2,700-acre campground at 2601 Bohemian Avenue in Monterey, California, United States, belonging to a private San Francisco-based gentleman's club known as the Bohemian Club. In mid-July each year, Bohemian Grove...
Hold it, stop right there. Go back up. I want to show the picture. Look who's at the table. Mostly Esau. Remember, this thing was established in 1873. 1873, we weren't allowed into Esau's groups, into Esau's organization. Right here, look, summer 1967, at where?
Owl's Nest Camp.
Owl's Nest. That's why that owl is on the back of the dollar, y'all. Time to wake up. Time to wake up. And notice how this man is the devil that the Bible speaks of. All right, summer 1967 at Owl's Nest Camp. Around the table, left to right, you had Preston Hotchkiss, Ronald Reagan, Harvey Hancock, Richard Nixon, Glenn T. Seaborg, Jack Sparks, Kevin Zinter, unidentified individual Edwin W. Pauley. Okay, go down, continue reading. Where you was at, Lemuel?
In mid-July each year, Bohemian Grove hosts a more than two-week encampment of some of the most prominent men in the world.
Prominent. These ain't regular men. You ain't have regular Jake walking up in there. These are prominent men. People in positions where they could influence certain things, where they could dictate certain policies. Okay? Prominent men. Go ahead. Click on, no, go back up. Click on, no, go down. I'm sorry. There's just so much to pull out. Go up. Let's just get to the point. Go to rituals and traditions. If you go back up, you could click on the link, the hyperlink. Ritual, yes, right there.
Traditions, right. Rituals, and symbols. Symbols. The club's patron saint is John of Nepomuk, who, according to legend, suffered death at the hands of a Bohemian monarch rather than disclose the confessional secrets of the queen. A large wood carving of Saint John in cleric robes with his index finger over his lips stands at the shore of the lake in the grove, symbolizing the secrecy kept by the grove's attendees throughout its long history. Since the founding of the club, the Bohemian Grove's mascot has been an owl.
Has been the owl. Go ahead.
Symbolizing wisdom.
Symbolizing what?
Wisdom.
Go to Isaiah 47 and 10 again, just in case you forgot. Isaiah 47 and verse 10.
Isaiah 47, verse 10.
Mm-hmm.
For thou hast trusted in thy wickedness.
Thou hast trusted in thy wickedness. Come on.
Thou hast said, none seeth me.
You said, nobody seeth me. Nobody's seen me. God did not see when I was orchestrating this whole thing. Okay? Creating Washington, D.C. in a form of a pentagram. All these idols around the place. All the divination that we used and witchcraft to create America from its inception. All the wickedness that we did to the so-called blacks, Hispanics, and natives. Go ahead.
Thy wisdom and thy knowledge.
Thy what?
Thy wisdom and thy knowledge.
Uh-huh.
It hath perverted thee.
You hear that? Thy wisdom and thy knowledge have perverted thee. That's why they use the owl symbolizing wisdom. Symbolizing wisdom. And we're going to read who gave this man the wisdom that he has soon. Okay, go back to this article.
Since the founding of the club, the Bohemian Grove's mascot has been an owl, symbolizing wisdom. A 30-foot hollow owl statue made of concrete over steel supports stands at the head of the lake in the grove. This statue was designed by sculptor and two-time club president Haig Patigan. It was constructed in the late 1920s.
Mm-hmm.
Since 1929, the owl shrine has served as the background of the yearly cremation of care ceremony.
Let's read about the cremation of care ceremony. Go ahead.
The cremation of care ceremony is a theatrical production mm-hmm. in which some of the club's members participate as actors.
Mm-hmm.
It was first conducted in 1881.
In 1881, go ahead.
The production was devised by James F. Bowman, with George T. Bromley playing the high priest.
Go ahead.
It was originally set up with the plot of the serious hijinks dramatic performance on the first weekend of the summer encampment, after which the spirit of care, slain by the jinx hero, was solemnly cremated.
Come on. And in 1881, when they first started it, they were using real babies. Jake babies, Negroes, blacks, okay? Now, when you go there now, they have the voice of Walter Cronkite making a sacrifice. They use his voice, Walter Cronkite, they use his voice at the Bohemian Grove. Go ahead.
Ceremony served as a catharsis for pent-up high spirits.
Witchcraft, go ahead.
And to present symbolically the salvation of the trees by the club.
Go ahead.
The cremation of care was separated from the other grove plays in 1913.
Go ahead.
And moved to the first night to become an exorcising of the demon.
An exorcising of the demon. Come on.
To ensure the success of the ensuing 2 weeks.
And it was very successful. Because remember, this is where the United Nations, this is where the making of the Manhattan Project, the discussions to put the Manhattan Project, was discussed over here. And guess what? The Most High allowed it to prosper. We're going to read why. Go ahead.
The Grove play was moved to the last weekend of the encampment.
Go ahead.
The ceremony takes place in front of the owl shrine. The moss and lichen-covered statue simulates a natural rock formation,
mm-hmm.
yet holds electrical and audio equipment within it.
Come on.
For many years, a recording of the voice of club member Walter Cronkite was used as
a
voice.
So many years, they used this man's voice, the same journalist that belongs to them as a member, they used his voice, come on.
Was used as the voice of the owl during the ceremony.
Witchcraft, go ahead.
Music and pyrotechnics accompany the ritual for dramatic effect.
Mm, unbelievable. Okay, drop that. Drop that. Get me, let's get some more. What was the next article? Okay, right here, this is a picture. This is a picture from what? From what happens inside of the Bohemian Grove. Remember what Richard Nixon said, and he was a part of it. All right, he opened his big mouth, and what happened? Anybody remember what happened with him? The scandal? Anybody know any history in here? Milkema? Some of y'all older than me, man. Y'all should know the history. I'm in my 30s. Come on.
Watergate happened.
Watergate. You open your mouth? You want to talk about the secrecy? And all the wickedness that we were doing? Okay. What happened? Watergate scandal. Okay. So what do we have here? Look at this. This is a photo from the Bohemian Club yearbook, volume 7, 1987 to 1996. What do we have here, brothers? Trannies. Trannies. This is what they do in there. Okay. All sin. Everything contrary to the Bible. This is where they get their power from, the devil.
The book of Matthew, chapter 4 and verse 8. Again, the devil taketh him up into an exceeding high mountain.
So this is when the devil was tempting who, brothers? Christ. Go ahead.
And showeth him all the kingdoms of the world, mm-hmm, and the glory of them, and saith unto him, all these things will I give thee, if thou wilt fall down and worship me.
You hear that? All these things will I give you, Christ, if you fall down and worship me. How do you worship the devil? Witchcraft, divination, different seances, right? Stargazings, all the things that we read America's into. So America is worshiping Satan. Satan gave America its powers since its inception. Since its inception. All right. Satan gave America its powers. Read on. Is that it on verse 9?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now get me. I still want that on the screen. Get me Leviticus chapter 20. Leviticus chapter 20. I want 2-3. Because we seen the owl earlier, and the owl, the Bohemian owl, was the same thing as Moloch. All of those things are synonymous, brothers and sisters. All they do is they take these different pagan gods, they repackage it, they rename it, and then they give it right back to you. And then you serve, okay? So you had Moloch and the Bohemian owl. Leviticus chapter 20, verse 2-3. Because remember I said this was found, the Bohemian Club was founded in 1873. When they started doing their rituals around the 1880s, those sacrifices, they used to use real babies, Negro babies, okay, as a sacrifice unto their god, the devil. Okay, read.
Leviticus chapter 20, verse 2. Mm-hmm. Again, thou shalt say to the children of Israel, whosoever he be of the children of Israel, or of the strangers that sojourn in Israel, that giveth any of his seed unto Molech, he shall surely be put to death.
So that was a Canaanite deity. That was a Canaanite deity. Moloch was a Canaanite deity, okay? And in a lot of Israel, guess what? We fell into that. That's the problem with the so-called blacks and Hispanics and natives. That's why God wants us to be what? Be ye separate, because we always start to follow after the customs of the heathens. We get tempted to follow them because we see some of them prospering. Guess what? Who gave them their power? The devil. The devil's job, Satan's job, is to have Esau walk completely contrary to the Bible so we know what not to do. Y'all brothers understand? Read that again, Leviticus 22 and 3.
Again, thou shalt say to the children of Israel, whosoever he be of the children of Israel or of the strangers that sojourn in Israel that giveth any of his seed unto Molech, mm-hmm, he shall surely be put to death.
Go ahead.
The people of the land shall stone him with stones, mm-hmm, and I will set my face against that man and will cut him off from among his people because he hath given of his seed unto Molech, mm-hmm, to defile my sanctuary and to profane my holy name.
So Esau, the white man, they know that the Bohemian owl, Molech, all of that is interchangeable. That's why they was doing those sacrifices, okay, at that time. Okay, that's why they was doing those sacrifices. Now, what do we have here? Give me Romans 1:22 and 23. We're still talking about these idols. Romans chapter 1:22 and 23.
Come Romans on. Chapter 1, verse 22. Professing themselves to be wise, they became fools and changed the glory of the incorruptible God into an image made like to corruptible man.
That's why God says what? Because of that wisdom and thy knowledge which have perverted thee. It says your wisdom has perverted you. You're professing yourself to be wise, but nah, you're not wise. You are the devil on earth, okay? And whatever wisdom you did obtain, you obtained that from the left-hand side. You obtained that from Satan himself. Read that again. Romans 1, verse 22.
Professing themselves to be wise, they became fools and changed the glory of the incorruptible God into an image made like to corruptible man.
And changed the glory of God into an image of corruptible man. That's why they worship in owls, they worship in statues, trees, and so forth, okay? So right here you have Lilith, which was a Semitic, an ancient Semitic deity, okay? Look at the bottom. What do you see next to her, brothers? What is that? What is that? A what? An owl, okay? An owl, the Bohemian owl, also known as Moloch, also known as Lilith. All right, queen of demons and of the night. So the Lilith owl was a Semitic myth owl, a female demon dwelling in deserted places and attacking children. Okay, so this was a Semitic deity, ancient Semitic deity. Read that. Minimize it so he could read it. Go ahead.
Lilith was the Sumerian goddess Belili, or Belili, or as we well know, Belial.
Belial. Go ahead.
And the Babylonian goddess Lilitu, which means the monster of the night.
Go ahead.
Lilitu is derived from the early Semitic word for night.
Come on.
She was Belit, the divine lady of the Canaanites. She has been identified with the Babylonian goddess Ishtar and has been referred to as the handmaiden of the Sumerian goddess Inanna. Barbara Walker, Women's Encyclopedia of Myths and Secrets.
So this was found in Barbara Walker's The Women's Encyclopedia of Myths and Secrets. Go ahead.
The symbols of Lilith are owls.
The symbols of Lilith are owls. Go ahead.
As Lilith is...
Can you see it? You can't see it?
Barely.
All right, I'll read it. The symbols of Lilith are owls. As Lilith is portrayed having the feet of them and wings, think harpy. The Sumerian goddess Lilith, known as the Lady of the Breasts, we heard that red word before, right? Who does that come from? Lady of the Breasts. Ishtar, also known as Easter, also known as Isis. All of those gods are the same. All of those gods are the same. That's what the scripture says, has the nations changed their gods? All of their gods are the same. They just repackage it, rename it, and give it right back to us. And a lot of us foolishly worship it, okay? It says, known as the Lady of the Breasts, was also symbolized as an owl. Lilith is symbolic of the reptilian bloodline. That's nonsense. However, she is related to the god Molech, which we just read in Leviticus, the 20th chapter, whose symbol is also an owl. And also a god of sacrifice. Another symbol of Molech is the six-pointed star or hexagram. Okay, that's for my Israelite brothers out there who are still holding on to that thing for dear life, that hexagram. There's no power in that hexagram. Okay, close this out. What is next? Right there. You see what was going on in ancient Babylon? They got an Edomite there, but it was us. You had the Hamites, the Canaanites. We were learning their ways, and we started sacrificing our children unto Molech. Okay? This is what we was doing. Their sons and their daughters, they sacrificed to the idols of Canaan. Molech, through a process of time, Molech became Lilith and also became that Bohemian owl that you see on the front of your dollar. Okay? On the front of your dollar. All right? Next. Did we read this already? Okay, let's get that. Lemuel?
Molech. Molech, also Molech, Moloch, Molecham, or Malcom, is the biblical name of a Canaanite god associated with child sacrifice through fire or war. The name Molech results from a dysphemic vocalization in the Second Temple period of a theonym based on the root milk, king. There are a number of Canaanite gods with names based on this root, which became summarily associated with Molech, including biblical Malcolm, great king, which appears to refer to a god of the Ammonites, as well as Tyrion, Melkart, and others.
Okay, drop that. Get me the next video. Okay, go down. These are other names for it. Owl of Athena, read.
Owl of Athena.
Uh-huh.
In Greek mythology, a little owl traditionally represents or accompanies Athena, the virgin goddess of wisdom.
The virgin goddess of who?
Of wisdom.
Now you see why they use the owl. The owl is always a representation of wisdom. That's why God said what? Thy wisdom and thy knowledge have what? Has what? Perverted thee. Perverted thee. Okay? So this was actually on a coin. This was minted on a coin, okay, in ancient Greece. Next article. Next one. These are known members of the Bohemian Grove. Lemuel, can you read it?
both George Bushes, Ronald Reagan, Henry Kissinger, Richard Nixon, Caspar Weinberger, Dick Cheney, Malcolm Forbes, Colin Powell, Helmut Schmidt, Stephen Bechtel, Bechtel Corp, James Baker, Jerry Cole, David Rockefeller.
David Rockefeller. We're going to read about him soon. Come on.
Newt Gingrich.
Go ahead.
Tom Johnson, president of CNN.
The mouth of the beast. Tom Johnson, the president of CNN. CNN, Caucasian News Network. Go ahead.
And former publisher of LA Times.
Uh-huh.
William Randolph Hearst Jr., Jack Howard, Charles Scripps of the Scripps Howard newspaper.
Newspaper.
Publishers.
Another form of the mouth of the beast to spread America's propaganda and lies and blasphemy. Go ahead.
Walter Cronkite.
Walter Cronkite. Go ahead.
On the CBS Board of Management.
Walter Cronkite on the CBS Board of Management. So he became an American icon. He was a journalist for 19 years. He was considered the most trusted man in America. Because if he's white, he's all right. Go ahead.
The Norman Cousins Global Governance Award, Walter Cronkite. World government is the structure necessary for global justice.
Pause.
You, sir.
It says world government is the structure necessary for global justice. What are they talking about? The New World Order. Their New World Order. Go ahead.
You're necessary for global justice. You, sir. You, sir, have been a lifelong advocate of this principle, and it is appropriate, therefore, that we present you with this amethyst geode.
So this is him right here. This is Walter Cronkite right here. Go ahead.
Thank you very much, Mr. President. And there are many of us here who had wished back a couple of decades ago that we had been addressing you with Mr. President in a slightly different environment. And thank you, Mrs. Annan, for those lovely words you spoke. I will treasure them, and I'm greatly honored, quite obviously, by the Norman Cousins Global Governance Award. I'll try to get it right, since I will be referring to it frequently, of course, from now on. There are two reasons, really, why I'm particularly grateful and honored by this award. The first, I believe, as Norman Cousins did, that the first priority of humankind in this difficult era is to establish an effective system of world law that will assure peace with justice among the peoples of all the world. But second, I feel rather sentimental about this award and this organization, because half a century ago, Norman Cousins offered me a job as the spokesman and the Washington lobbyist for the really nascent organization called World Federalists. I was honored. He and Oscar Hammerstein met me in the Waldorf and twisted my arm quite vigorously, get me to take the job, to take the place of Ted Waller, who was the first lobbyist and a noted supporter of the World Federalist Movement. I chose instead, it turned out, to continue in the world of journalism. For many years, I did my best to report on the issues of the day with as much fairness as I possibly could, in objective a manner as possible to achieve. When I had my own strong opinions, I tried to put them aside for the moment in the interest of fairness.
So what he's saying is, as when he was working as a journalist, there's a lot of things he wanted to say, but he did not. He put his emotions aside and how he truly felt to the side when he was working as a journalist. Go ahead.
However.
Now you said, however. Go ahead.
My circumstances are considerably different. I'm in a position to speak my mind, and by God, I'm going to do it.
So now you're saying, however, things are different now. Why? Because he retired. Now I can speak my mind. So let's hear how the devil on earth speaks. I mean, thinks. Go ahead.
You know, those of us who are living today can truly influence the future of civilization. We can influence whether our planet is going to live or die, whether it's going to drift into chaos and violence, or whether through a monumental educational and political effort, a monumental effort, we will achieve a world of peace under a system of law where individual violators of that law are brought to justice. For how many thousands of years now have we humans been what we insist on calling civilized? And yet, in total contradiction, we also persist in the savage belief that we must occasionally, at least, settle our arguments by killing each other. While we spend much of our time and a great deal of our treasure in preparing for war, we see no comparable effort in establishing peace. Meanwhile, emphasizing the sloth in this regard, those advocates who work for world peace by urging a system of world law and order, world government, if you please, are called impractical dreamers. Those impractical dreamers are entitled, it seems to me, to ask their critics, what is so darn practical about war? First, we Americans are going to have to yield up some of our sovereignty.
So in order to establish this world government, this new world order that Esau wants to have it, he's saying, well, first and foremost, a lot of Americans are going to have to give up some of their sovereignty, some of their rights. Go ahead.
That's going to be, to many, a bitter pill.
For many, it's going to be very bitter. Okay, and guess what? Esau is trying to start that now. They've been starting it. Go ahead.
Courage, a lot of faith, a lot of persuasion for them to come along with us on this necessity.
In order for them to persuade you, what must they do? What must they use? The media, popular persuasion. Go ahead.
Our forefathers believed that the closer the laws are to the people, the better. Cities legislate on local matters, of course. States make decisions on the matters within their borders. And the national government deals with issues that transcend the states, such as interstate commerce, foreign relations. That's what we mean by federalism. Today, we must develop federal structures on a global level. To deal with world problems, we need a system of enforceable world law, a democratic federal world government. You know, what Alexander Hamilton wrote about the need for law among the 13 states applies today to the approximately 200 sovereignties in our global village, all of which are going to have to be convinced to give up some of that sovereignty to the better, greater union. Hamilton said, and it's not going to be easy, Hamilton said, to look for a continuation of harmony between a number of independent, unconnected sovereignties in the same neighborhood would be to disregard the uniform course of human events and to set at defiance the accumulated experience of ages. Most important, we should sign and ratify the Treaty for a Permanent International Criminal Court.
Here's the point. The point is coming up soon. It's coming up.
That is now at the core of the World Federalist Movement's drive. That court will enable the world to hold individuals accountable for their crimes against humanity. Their leader, Pat Robertson, has written in a book a few years ago that we should have a world government, but only when the Messiah arrives.
Which is biblical, because there will be a new world order when Christ returns. Go ahead.
Rose, and literally, any attempt to achieve world order before that time must be the work of the devil.
Absolutely, it is the work of the devil. Go ahead. But look at his reaction. Look what he said.
I'm glad to sit here at the right hand of Satan. Let us hear the peace.
He said, if so, I am glad to sit here at the right hand of Satan. And we read where America got its power from, Satan. So guess what? Walter Cronkite is actually telling the truth. Finally, the white man has told the truth about himself. He is sitting at the right hand of Satan. Okay, you could bring that down. Give me the next video with Aaron Russo. Aaron Russo was another gentleman who was into the media productions and so forth, but he wanted to run for governor of Las Vegas at one time. Go ahead. You could skip through this. Skip through this.
I fell into a female attorney I knew who called me up one day and said, one of the Rockefellers would like to meet you. I made a video called Mad as Hell.
So he had a meeting with one of the Rockefellers. Okay, go ahead.
He'd seen the video and wanted to meet me and knew I was running for governor of Nevada. So sure, I'd love to meet him. And I met him and I liked him. And he was a very, very smart man. And we used to talk and share ideas and thoughts. And he's the one who told me 11 months before 9/11 ever happened that there was going to be an event. Never told me what the event was going to be. But there was going to be an event, and out of that event, we were going to invade Afghanistan to run pipelines from the Caspian Sea. We were going to invade Iraq, you know, to take over the oil fields, establish a base in the Middle East, and make it all part of the New World Order. And we'd go after Chavez in Venezuela. And sure enough, later 9/11 happened, and I remember he was telling me how, how you're going to see soldiers looking in caves for people in Afghanistan and Pakistan and all these places, and there's going to be this war on terror, which is no real enemy, and the whole thing is a giant hoax, you know. But it's a way for the government to take over the American people.
He told you it was going to be a hoax.
Oh yeah, oh yeah. There's no question. He says there's going to be war on terror, and he's laughing. Who are we fighting? I mean, why do you think 9/11 happened?
So this is one of the Rockefellers that was speaking to him. Go ahead.
And then nothing's happened since then. Do you think that our security is so great here that these people who pulled off 9/11, who were able to can't knock down another plane? Come on, it's ridiculous. 9/11 was done by people in our own government and our own banking system to perpetuate the fear of the American people into subordinating themselves to anything the government wants them to do.
Popular persuasion. So that was, of course, we all know about that point of time with 9/11, the popular persuasion to get the American people, persuade public opinion to be on the side of America going into war with Afghanistan, later into Iraq, and then now they want Iran. We see what's going on. All right? All to establish their new world order, which will not happen. Get me Genesis, the 10th chapter. Because this happened in ancient Babylon. Same way it's happening now in modern Babylon, America. Okay, Babylon the Great, it happened in ancient. We want Genesis chapter 10. I want 8 to 10 first.
Genesis chapter 10, verse 8. And Cush begat Nimrod. He began to be a mighty one in the earth.
So Nimrod was a mighty one in the earth. Come on.
He was a mighty hunter before the Lord.
He was a mighty what?
Hunter before the Lord.
Physically and spiritually, he was a mighty hunter before the Lord. He was hunting the souls of men as well. Guess what? Esau is also known as the cunning hunter. Okay, go ahead.
Wherefore it is said, even as Nimrod, the mighty hunter before the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
And the beginning of his kingdom was Babel.
Babel, that's where you get Babylon from. Babel means what, brothers? Confusion. Go ahead.
And Erech. And Akkad and Calne in the land of Shinar.
Shinar was the capital of Babylon. Now jump to 11, 1 to 9. Come on.
Chapter 11, verse 1. And the whole earth was of one language,
mm-hmm,
and of one speech.
Mm-hmm.
And it came to pass as they journeyed from the east that they found a plain in the land of Shinar, and they dwelt there. And they said one to another, go to, let us make brick and burn them thoroughly. And they had brick for stone, and slime had they for mortar. And they said, go to, let us build us a city and a tower, whose top may reach unto heaven. And let us make us a name, lest we be scattered abroad upon the face of the whole earth.
Come on.
And the Lord came down to see the city and the tower, which the children of men builded.
Go ahead.
And the Lord said, behold, the people is one,
mm-hmm.
and they have all one language.
Go ahead.
And this they begin to do.
That's that new world order that Nimrod was trying to establish, one world government. Go ahead.
And now nothing will be restrained from them,
mm-hmm.
which they have imagined to do.
Come on.
Go to. Let us go down, and there confound their language, mm-hmm. that they may not understand one another's speech. So the Lord scattered them abroad from thence upon the face of all the earth.
So ancient Babylon, you had Nimrod under Babylon, then you have today's Babylon trying to do the same thing, trying to do the same thing, all right? Establish a new world order. We want 2 Esdras, chapter 11. 2 Esdras, now I need you to read a little bit faster, let me will. 2 Esdras, chapter 11, 39 to 42 only. 2 Esdras, chapter 11, 39 to 42.
Let's 2 go. Esdras, chapter 11, verse 39. Art not thou it that remainest of the four beasts whom I made to reign in my world?
So the fourth beast is whom? Who's the fourth beast? Emmanuel, Officer Emmanuel. Rome. But America is an extension of what? Rome. Go ahead.
Whom I made to reign in my world, that the end of their times might come through them. And the fourth came and overcame all the beasts that were past, mm-hmm. and had power over the world with great fearfulness.
Come on.
And over the whole compass of the earth with much wicked oppression. And so long time dwelt he.
So they had power over the world with much wicked oppression. Wicked oppression. How did America get this place? Through what? Witchcraft, divination, and wicked oppression. Come on.
And so long time dwelt he upon the earth with deceit. For the earth hast thou not judged with truth.
They did not judge the earth with this Bible at all. They walk contrary to God's Bible. Go ahead.
Verse 42. For thou hast afflicted the meek, thou hast hurt the peaceable.
The meek and the peaceable is us. Okay? The meek and the peaceable is us. Come on.
Thou hast loved liars and destroyed the dwellings of them that brought forth fruit, and hast cast down the walls of such as did thee no harm.
Like they did the tribe of Gad. Okay, that's why that eagle got that olive branch in their hand. Remember, the eagle is a bird of prey, but it has an olive branch in its hand. Why? Psalms 55, verse 21. Psalms 55, verse 21.
Psalms chapter 55, verse 21. The words of his mouth were smoother than
the
butter.
The words of Esau's mouth is smoother than butter. So smooth that it got what? All of the... those native tribes to sign those peace treaties, and then America broke every last treaty. Smoother than butter. Go ahead.
But war was in his heart.
But what?
But war was in his heart.
But war was in his heart. Go ahead.
His words were softer than oil.
Mm-hmm.
Yet were they drawn swords.
Yet were they drawn swords. Give me Ezekiel 28. Ezekiel 28, 1 through 6.
Ezekiel chapter 28, verse 1. The word of the Lord came again unto me, saying, Son of man, say unto the prince of Tyrus.
That's America, prophetic speaking about America. Go ahead.
Thus saith the Lord God, because thine heart is lifted up, and thou hast said, I am a God. I sit in the seat of God, in the midst
of the
That's
how you know it's America, because Esau does that. I am a God, and I sit in the seat of God. Go ahead.
In the midst of the seas.
Mm-hmm. In the midst of the seas. In the midst of the seas. What is it talking about? Why does it say in the midst of the seas, Officer Azan? In the midst of the seas, brother man right there. What's your name again, brother? Kim?
Akim.
Akim. Yes, okay.
Sir. Because of their Navy ships.
Navy ships. Okay, what else? Officer Emmanuel? Embassies, very good, very good. Let's get, very good, very good. Y'all cooking. Get me Revelation. Revelation 17. I want Revelation 17, and I want verse 1, I believe it is. If I remember correctly.
Yes, sir. Revelation chapter 17, verse 1. And there came one of the seven angels, which had the seven vials, and talked with me, saying unto me, come hither. I will show unto thee the judgment of the great whore.
The great whore. Go ahead.
That sitteth upon many waters.
That sitteth upon many waters. Why? Because of those embassies, those ships. America is in all nations. America is in all nations. Sitteth upon many waters. Jump down to verse 15.
Verse 15. And he saith unto me, the waters which thou sawest, where the whore sitteth, are peoples and multitudes. And nations. And tongues.
That's why that United Nations was set up at the Bohemian Grove. To what? Because all prophecy had to be fulfilled. Whatever the Most High says does not come back void. Okay? Go back to Ezekiel.
Ezekiel chapter 28, verse 2. Son of man, say unto the prince of Tyrus, thus saith the Lord God, because thine heart is lifted up, and thou hast said, I am a God. I sit in the seat of God, in the midst of the seas.
In all nations, go ahead.
Yet thou art a man.
Yet thou art a man. Amen. Amen. What man are we making reference to? Esau. Esau, the white man. Okay? You can find that in Isaiah 14. Isaiah 14, verse 16. Okay? Read on.
And not God. Though thou set thine heart as the heart of God.
Though you try to set your mind as the heart of God, you are no God. The real gods on this earth are the Israelites, the so-called black Hispanics and natives. Okay, go ahead.
Behold, thou art wiser than Daniel.
But behold, thou art wiser than Daniel. Wiser than Daniel. Come on.
There is no secret that they can hide from thee.
Why does it say thou art wiser than Daniel? There is no secret that they can hide from thee. We just seen it. All of the secrecies. Witchcrafts that these people were doing that none of us knew about, even during that time. And now, that's what blows some of your mind. The owl on the dollar, that will blow a Negro's mind away. The representation, what is the pyramid? What is this? What is that? A lot of Negroes do not understand what they're looking at. A lot of them don't have the knowledge that you brothers have. But it says, there is no secret that they can hide from thee. Get me Psalms. Psalm 64, verse 6.
Psalms chapter 64, verse 6. They search out iniquities.
They search out iniquities. They search out iniquities, meaning sin. Go ahead.
They accomplish a diligent search.
They do a diligent search. Come on.
Both the inward thought of every one of them and the heart is deep.
Their inward thought and the heart of them is deep. Deep thinking to do sin. Deep thinking to do sin. Okay, discover secrets. That's why in Ezekiel 28, verse 3, it says there is no secret that they can hide from thee. Go back to Ezekiel, please.
Ezekiel chapter 28, verse 4. With thy wisdom and with thine understanding.
With thy wisdom and thine understanding. That's why they use that owl. That owl is supposed to be a representation of wisdom. And on the left-hand side, if there's a representation of all those pagan deities that America serves. The owl, the owl. Okay, go ahead.
Thou hast gotten thee riches.
With thy wisdom and understanding, thou hast gotten thee riches. Come on.
And hast gotten gold and silver into thy treasures.
Let's go to Revelation 17, verse 4. Revelation 17, verse 4.
Revelation chapter 17, verse 4. And the woman was arrayed in purple and scarlet color, and decked with gold and precious stones.
Gold
and
precious stones. This is making reference to America. Decked out, rich, glorious. By what? Colonizing nations. You read about that in Deuteronomy 28, 33. Taking all the world's resources. Go ahead.
Having a golden cup in her hand full of abominations and filthiness of her fornication.
You hear that? They in the cup in her hand full of abominations and filthiness of her fornication. That's why in Isaiah it says, thy wisdom and thy knowledge have perverted thee. Okay? Get me, stay in that book, Revelation 18. Revelation 18 and verse 3.
Revelation chapter 18, verse 3. Mm-hmm. For all nations have drunk of the wine of the wrath of her fornication, and the kings of the earth have committed fornication with her, and the merchants of the earth are
waxed.
That's
trade. The merchants trade. That's how America gets rich. Trade, not only colonizing, but trade. Trade, buying and selling. And between buying and selling, there is a multitude of sin, wickedness going on. Go ahead.
And the merchants of the earth are waxed rich through the abundance of her delicacy.
Jump to verse 7.
Verse 7. How much she hath glorified herself and lived deliciously, so much torment and sorrow give her. For she saith in her heart, I sit a queen.
For she, remember in the beginning, we seen that, the video in the beginning, and it portrayed America as a woman. It says, for she saith in her heart, go ahead.
I sit a queen. And am no widow, and shall see no sorrow.
America think they're going to last forever, but God is saying no. America think they're going to establish their new world order. God is saying no. Destruction is coming to this place at the hand of my people when they apply Isaiah the 13th chapter. Keep the commandments, teach the commandments, teach the laws, the prophecies, the angels is going to make everything come to pass. Okay, go ahead, read.
Verse 8, therefore shall a plague come in one day, death and mourning and famine, and she shall be utterly burned with fire.
Mm.
But strong is the Lord God who judgeth her.
Go to verse 19.
Verse 19, and they cast dust on their heads and cried, weeping and wailing, saying, alas, alas, that great city wherein were made rich all that had ships in the sea.
That's going into merchants. Go ahead.
By reason of her costliness.
Uh-huh.
For in 1 hour she made desolate.
So that's all the riches. That's how America got rich. Go to Ezekiel 28 and 5.
Ezekiel 28, verse 5.
Old Revelations. We ain't done with that. Go ahead.
By thy great wisdom and by thy traffic hast thou increased thy riches.
Who was America trafficking? It says, by thy great wisdom and by thy traffic. How's that what?
Hast thou increased thy riches?
Has thy increased thy riches? Is that it?
And thine heart is lifted up because of thy riches.
And thy heart is lifted up because of thy riches. Is that it on verse 5?
Yes, sir.
Get me Revelation 18. I want 11 to 13. Let's see what America was trafficking. Okay? Trafficking with much sorcery and wickedness and evil. Come on.
Revelation chapter 18, verse 11. And the merchants of the earth shall weep and mourn over her, for no man buyeth their merchandise anymore. The merchandise of gold and silver.
Read faster.
And precious stones and of pearls and fine linen and purple and silk and scarlet and all fine wood and all manner vessels of ivory and all manner vessels of most precious wood and of brass and iron and marble and cinnamon and odors and ointments and frankincense and wine and oil and fine flour and wheat and beasts and sheep and horses and chariots and slaves and souls.
And slaves. That's why we read in Ezekiel 28, verse 5, said traffic and slaves. Come on.
And souls of men.
And souls of men. And souls of men. Okay. Get me a Sirach. Sirach 39. I want Sirach 39, 26 to 27.
Sirach chapter 39, verse 26. The principal things for the whole use of man's life are water, fire, iron and salt, flour of wheat, honey, milk and the blood of the grape, and oil and clothing.
Oil and clothing. We read about all of these different things, all of these resources in Revelation chapter 18, verse 11 to 13. But listen to what God says about these resources. Go ahead. Come on.
All these things are for the good to the godly.
All of these things are for good to the godly, come on.
So to the sinners, they are turned into evil.
But God says to the sinners, these things are turned into evil. That's why when you go to Revelation 18, I'll get it. You got to get it. Revelation chapter 18, verse 13, when it goes over these different resources, at the end it says, and slaves and souls of men. Because the evil will take these things and what? They'll use it to slay the souls of men. To try to get these resources, they'll slay the souls of men. Y'all hear what the Bible is saying? It's beautiful stuff right here. So now show me the next video.
The Middle East is fucked. We should know. We fucked it. 6 of the 10 fastest growing economies are in sub-Saharan Africa. Countries rich in mineral wealth. Coltan for our computers, cobalt, our batteries, phosphates for our agriculture, nuclear ore for our power. These are the things, gentlemen, that the wars of the next 20, 30 years will be fought over. A huge deposit of cobalt was discovered in Mali just over 2 years ago. Back then, we approached the Malian government about mining rights. They told us that those rights were going to the Chinese.
Just like today.
So we set about to create the conditions to make sure that wouldn't happen.
How do you create those conditions? Not only popular persuasion, but war. You make things happen. You make accidents happen, like explosions, car accidents, sudden death, COVID-19. Go ahead.
Last week, one of our Australian subsidiaries, thank you, Lackland, secured those rights.
So the Australian subsidiary secured those mining rights when they put the Moabite washpot to death. This is what America does. They put it in their movies and it goes whoop, right over everybody's head. But it's right there. Go ahead, come on.
Molly hit a few bumps, but I'm delighted to report that it worked. And if it can work there, there's no reason it can't work in other mineral-rich countries across Africa. We create the chaos, and then we move in and capitalize on that chaos. We're looking at the long term here, gentlemen. Rates of return that'll make Iraq and Afghanistan look like chicken feed.
You hear that? That's all. That's Esau's M.O. Conquer, and destroy and take minerals. Take everything. Next video. And that's what they're planning to do in Africa. Okay? They already done. They done did it in Iraq. All right? They did it in Afghanistan. All right? They're trying to do it in Iran. But guess what? They're currently doing this in Africa. All right? Go ahead. Play this.
Since we met you people 500 years ago, look at us. We've given everything. You are still taking. It's true. I mean, where would the whole Western world be without Africa? Our cocoa, our timber, our gold, our diamonds, our platinum, our whatever. Everything you are is us. I am not saying it. It's a fact. In return for all of this, what have we got? Nothing. Anti-personnel indoctrination against ourselves. If you go and cook your horrible diseases like AIDS, you say it is us. You brought us tuberculosis. We didn't have this big cough until white people came here. In exchange for Africa giving Europe 500 solid years of our people, I mean, not Europe, the Western world, of our human beings to work your canes, to dig your gold, to take in gold itself, diamond, I mean, you know, fish, peanuts, palm oil, everything. In exchange for that, we have got nothing. Nothing.
Close that out. That's why the Bible says this man have not stolen. Have you not stolen till you had enough? Have you not stolen till you had enough? That's the oppression our people are facing. But God has another plan. Get me Nahum. Nahum, chapter 3, 1 to 5. You're going to read quickly, Lemuel. Nahum, 3, 1 to 5.
Nahum, chapter 3, verse 1. Mm-hmm. Woe to the bloody city. It is all full of lies and robbery. The prey departeth not. The noise of a whip and the noise of the rattling of the wheels and of the prancing horses and of the jumping chariots. The horsemen lifted up both the bright sword and the glittering spear. And there was a multitude of slain and a great number of carcasses. And there was none end of their corpses. They stumble upon their corpses. Because of the multitude of the whoredoms of the well-favored harlot, the mistress of witchcrafts.
The mistress of who?
Of witchcraft.
That's what this class was going into earlier. Witchcraft. Come on.
That selleth nations through her whoredoms.
That what?
That selleth nations.
That selleth nations, Israelites, blacks, Hispanics, natives, Israelites. Go ahead.
Through her whoredoms.
Through her whoredoms. Come on.
And families through her witchcrafts. Behold, I am against thee, saith the Lord of hosts, and I will discover thy skirts upon thy face.
And I will discover thy skirts upon thy face. That's what the Most High is doing now. All of these secret behind the door things that Esau is doing, the Most High is revealing it, and we're bringing it out in these classes. Get me Isaiah 47 verse 2. Isaiah 47 verse 2. Most High God says, I'm going to discover thy secrets in your skirts. What is he talking about? Isaiah 47 verse 2. Come on.
Isaiah 47 verse 2. Take the millstones and grind meal.
This is talking about Babylon. Go ahead.
Uncover thy locks. Make bare the leg. Uncover the thigh. Pass over the rivers. Thy nakedness shall be uncovered. Yea, thy shame shall be seen. I will take vengeance and I will not meet thee as a man.
So that's the end thereof.
All right, so earlier we seen a video with the young sister from Nigeria that was talking about how Esau comes in. For the past 500 years, they've been coming into Africa, taking all the resources and so forth. So now we have another article that validates that. All right, go ahead, Lemuel.
Four more ways the CIA has meddled in Africa.
So we're talking about the United States CIA. Okay, go ahead, go down. So we have Nelson Mandela, who was imprisoned in 1962 and later convicted of trying to violently overthrow the government. All right, so it says the U.S. Central Intelligence Agency, CIA, has a long history of involvement in African affairs. So Sunday's reports that the 1962 arrest of Nelson Mandela came following a CIA tip-off don't come as a huge surprise. Most incidents came during the Cold War when the U.S. and the Soviet Union battled for influence across the continent. We always hear about the European scramble for Africa movement, okay? So this is one of them. Russia, the Soviet, was trying to take control of the continent. Why? What do you think the Soviets and America want out of the continent? Officer Eman.
Resources.
All right, give me Deuteronomy 28, verse 33. Deuteronomy 28, verse 33.
Deuteronomy chapter 28, verse 33. The fruit of thy land and all thy labors shall a nation which thou knowest not eat up.
So the Europeans colonized Africa and they took the fruit of thy land. Oftentimes when we read that, we automatically think about fruits, vegetables, and so forth. It's more than that. It's talking about diamonds, bauxite, cobalt, oil, okay? That's Esau's primary focus on the continent. Wherever we were scattered, wherever we were colonized. Go ahead.
And thou shalt be only oppressed and crushed always.
Okay, let's get back to this article. So it says CIA covert operations are by their very nature hard to prove definitively. But research into the agency's work, as well as revelations by former CIA employees, has thrown up several cases where the agency tried to influence events. So here are four primary examples. We have Patrice Lumumba. How many of y'all heard of Patrice Lumumba? Officer Zahn, all right, a few brothers. Patrice, hold up, I gotta read it. You're going too fast. 1961, Patrice Lumumba's assassination in Congo. And it's funny that we're talking about Congo because Congo is the first country to put up their hands and volunteer for France to come in and use them as test subjects for COVID-19. The Democratic Republic of Congo is the first. But if Patrice Lumumba was in power, he would not go for that. So this is what they do. They go in, they infiltrate, they overthrow, they start a coup d'etat, take the oil, all of those resources that we read in Sirach 39, verse 26, they go in there for that main reason. All of those resources that we read in Revelation 18 from 11 to 13, this is how they got it, colonize it, all right? Patrice Lumumba became the first prime minister of the newly independent Congo in 1960, but he lasted just a few months in the job before he was overthrown and assassinated in January 1961. Down. In 2002, former colonial power, Belgium, admitted responsibility for its part in the killing. However, the U.S., the harlot themselves, the U.S. has never explained its role despite long-held suspicions. And that's what they try to do. They try to put their hand up, but we didn't know what happened. Trust me, America knew what happened. America was behind that day. All right? U.S. President Dwight D. Eisenhower, concerned about communism, was worried about Congo following a similar path to Cuba. According to source quoted in Death in the Congo, a book about the assassination, President Eisenhower gave an order for the assassination of Lumumba. There was no discussion. The National Security Council meeting simply moved on. Meaning, when it says there was no discussion, meaning they knew about it and they turned a blind eye to it. That's it. So basically, if you don't speak up, you agree with it. So all the Edomites on the National Security Council agreed with the assassination of Lumumba. However, a CIA plan to lace Lumumba's toothpaste with poison, that sounds familiar. Who am I thinking about? Brothers. Who am I thinking? Who else did the CIA or the FBI, I should say, I'm giving y'all the answer by putting it this way. Who else did the CIA or the governments try to assassinate using toothpaste poison? Anybody know? Go ahead, Officer Zahn.
Malcolm X.
Malcolm X, but they failed. They tried to, but they failed. It says, however, a CIA plan to lace Lumumba's toothpaste with poison was never carried out. Lawrence Devlin, who was a station chief in Congo at the time, told the BBC in 2000, a survey of declassified US government documents from the era notes that the CIA initially focused on removing Lumumba, not only through assassination if necessary, but also with an array of non-lethal undertakings. While there is no doubt the CIA wanted him dead, the survey does not indicate direct US involvement in his eventual killing. Devils that the Bible speaks of. All right, the number two guy, 1965 overthrow of Kwame Nkrumah in Ghana. Damn. Ghana's first president, Kwame Nkrumah, was overthrown in a military coup in 1966 while he was out of the country. He later suspected that the U.S. had a role in his downfall, and in a 1978 book, former CIA intelligence officer John Stockwell backed this theory up. So it was no longer a conspiracy theory, it was true. In Search of Enemies, he writes that an official sanction for the coup does not appear in CIA documents, but he writes, the Accra Station, Accra is a city in Ghana. The Accra Station was nevertheless encouraged by headquarters to maintain contact with dissidents. It was given a generous budget, meaning they were given a budget to pay off people. When you research Lumumba, they paid his boy to overthrow him. They gave him $500. All right, a Negro will overthrow you quick for a piece of gum and $2, right? It was given a generous budget and maintained intimate contact with the plotters as a coup was hatched. And the plotters were black people, okay? He says that the CIA in Ghana got more involved and its operatives were given unofficial credit for the eventual coup. A declassified US government document does show awareness of a plot to overthrow the president, but does not indicate any official backing. They're doing it again. It's the same thing they said for Lumumba. All right, another declassified document written after the coup describes Nkrumah's fall as a fortuitous windfall. Nkrumah was doing more to undermine our interests than any other black African. So basically, he was for his people. That's what they're saying. He was for his people and not the US. Number three, opposition to the MPLA in Angola, 1970. In Angola, three competing groups fought for control after independence from Portugal in 1975, with the MPLA under Agostinho Neto taking over the capital, Luanda. Mr. Stockwell, chief of CIA's covert operations in Angola, in the word covert means what? Huh? To destroy the poor secret. It's a secret. That's what the scripture says. They went to destroy the poor secretly. Because if it was for good, why does the operation have to be covert? If they had good intentions behind it. It says, Mr. Stockwell, chief of CIA's covert operations in Angola, in 1975, writes that Washington decided to oppose the MPLA as it was seen as closer to the Soviet Union and support the FNLA and UNITA instead, even though all three had help from communist countries. The CIA then helped secretly import weapons, including 30,000 rifles through Kinshasa in neighboring Zaire, now known as the Democratic Republic of Congo, Mr. Stockwell says in a video documentary. Okay, he adds that the CIA officers also trained fighters from armed combat. A declassified US government document detailing a discussion between the head of the CIA, the Secretary of State, and others indicates the support the CIA gave to the forces fighting the MPLA. Go down. Last one. 1982, supporting Hassan Habré in Chad. Okay, Hassan Habré failed in his attempt to take power by force in Chad in 1980, but his efforts led President Wakunu Awude to call on help from the Libyan leader Muammar Gaddafi, whose soldiers successively beat back Habré's challenge and forced him into exile. A proposed alliance between Libya and Chad began to unsettle the U.S., especially as Gaddafi began to be seen as a supporter of anti-U.S. activities. And we all know what happened to Muammar Gaddafi many years later. In Foreign Policy magazine, Michael Broner writes that the CIA director with the Secretary of State coalesced around the idea of launching a covert war in partnership with Habré. It is alleged that the U.S. then backed Habré's overthrow of the president in 1982 and then supported him throughout his brutal rule. So that's how America got down. That's how America gets down. Now, show me the other article. This is what's going on now in the year 2020 while everybody is asleep. Everybody's still asleep and being distracted by COVID-19. This is what's going on. Read that, let me roll.
The coup attempt in Venezuela seems ridiculous, but don't forget, regime change is the U.S. goal.
This is what's going on now. Read the date. Is there a date on it right there where it says May 4th?
May 4th, 2020.
Go ahead.
Picture the following scene. Two former Venezuelan Special Forces soldiers are captured while trying to land on a beach in the United States. They confess on camera to being part of a wider plot to capture and kidnap the American president. That same day, back in Venezuela, another ex-Special Forces soldier with connections to the longtime bodyguard of Venezuela's president, Nicolas Maduro, releases a video announcing the two men were working for his private security company on a mission to detain and extract President Donald Trump and bring down the government in Washington, D.C.
He's giving you a comparison. Go ahead.
2 days later, the Venezuelan foreign minister, who also happens to be the former head of the country's feared intelligence agency, gives a press conference at which he chooses to deny only direct involvement in the operation. If we had been involved, it would have gone differently, he added with a smirk.
Go ahead. He's being facetious. He said, imagine if they tried to do that to Donald Trump, because this is what America's trying to do to Venezuela. And we're going to read why. Go ahead.
What do you think the reaction would be here in the United States among political and media elites in national security circles? Wouldn't the U.S. press be running endless pieces denouncing and berating Maduro? Wouldn't cable news be rolling on it? Does anyone doubt that the U.S. military would be preparing to attack targets across Venezuela in retaliation? Yet that is exactly what we have witnessed over the past week, but in reverse and without any sense of shock or outrage in the United States.
Because they don't care. They don't care because America is about imperialism. America, United Snakes of America, is about what? Establishing a new world order and putting all dark nations under their feet. Let's not forget, our brothers over here in Venezuela is part of the 12 tribes. Because I know a lot of brothers are still asleep. That's the tribe of Asher. Let's not forget. Okay, this is one of the sleazeballs over here. Ex-Green Beret. Go down right there. That dude, he's captured. So they got him on live video. Go down. Go ahead.
On Monday, it was Venezuela that captured two former U.S. Special Forces soldiers, Luke Denman and Aaron Barry, after what authorities described as their botched beach landing in the fishing village of Chuo. A video was released of Denman telling his interrogators that he had been tasked with capturing the Venezuelan president. Meanwhile, Florida-based ex-Green Beret Jordan Goodrow, head of the private security firm Silvercorp USA, appeared in a video alongside a former Venezuelan military officer in combat fatigues, in which he confirmed that Denman and Barry were working for him.
So Jordan is the guy that hired them, okay? And the award was $100,000 to go over there and capture Maduro, which is the standing president, Okay, you'll either assassinate him or capture him. Go ahead.
Press reports have since revealed that Goudreau had meetings with former longtime Trump bodyguard Keith Schiller, had signed a multi-million dollar contract with the U.S.-backed Venezuelan opposition, and also claims to have been in contact with the office of Vice President Mike Pence.
Some wicked stuff going on. Evil. Go ahead.
On Wednesday, Secretary of State Mike Pompeo, a former director of the CIA, spoke at a press conference where he issued his very carefully worded denial. There was no U.S. government direct involvement in this.
Now, you hear what he's saying? Mike Pompeo? Remember the article we just read by the CIA? Long time, you had people that retired from the CIA would tell the truth, write it in books and so forth, and America would just deny it. That's the same thing they're doing. All they do is lie, 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 and lie. Go ahead.
There was no U.S. government direct involvement in this. He also couldn't help but brag to reporters about how it would have gone differently if the United States had been behind it. Memo to Pompeo, Google, Bay of Pigs.
So he's trying to make mockery of it, make light of it, because they're embarrassed that two former military specialists, Green Berets, were captured. And it was a botched plan, and it failed miserably. Go ahead.
Who knows? Perhaps Washington wasn't involved this time. Perhaps Trump is correct to say that this particular fiasco, which sounds like the plot of a bad Hollywood movie, has nothing to do with our government. Then again, this is an administration of liars.
This is a what?
Administration of liars.
So who wrote this article? Another Edomite. So he know that his own people are liars. Go ahead.
Liars, fabulous, and grifters. Dishonesty is the hallmark of the Trump White House.
Dishonesty is the hallmark of all Edomites. Go ahead.
Their denials, therefore, are pretty worthless.
Come on.
Plus, there's the recent history to consider. The demonization and strangulation of Venezuela has been a bipartisan project in Washington, D.C. since the rise of Hugo Chavez and the socialist pink tide in the late 1990s.
Go ahead.
In 2002, the Bush administration encouraged and supported a failed coup against Chavez.
So they tried to kill Chavez multiple times, all right? We heard that before, and they failed too. Go ahead.
As a later reminded former Bush official Otto Reich, who was accused of meeting with the plotters beforehand, the CIA had warned him and his colleagues that a coup attempt would be made 5 days before it occurred.
Mm. Go ahead.
In 2015, the Obama administration made the absurd decision to formally declare Venezuela an unusual and extraordinary threat to U.S. national security.
They weren't a threat to U.S. national security. What's going on is, like the scripture says about, let's get that real quick, hold that. Get me what the scripture says about Asher.
Deuteronomy 33:24. And of Asher he said.
And of Asher he said, Venezuela, come on.
Let Asher be blessed with children.
Let him be blessed with children, because they have mad kids. Come on.
Let him be acceptable to his brethren.
Let him be acceptable to his brethren. Acceptable to his brethren. That's talking about the rest of the tribes. Go ahead.
And let him dip his foot in oil.
And let him dip his foot in oil, meaning the land that they possess will be full of oil. That's why they're going after Maduro in Venezuela. Okay? And Obama, he's a chocolate-covered Edomite. He's another one, okay? Talking about Venezuela is a threat to U.S. national security. How is that? They don't even have ICBMs. You're the threat. You're the virus, okay? Close this out and get me the other article. Because we just read how it said, Asher's foot shall be dipped in oil. Get the other article and go back to Sirach so we don't lose the point. Sirach chapter 39, verse 26. And then you're going to come back to Deuteronomy 33, verse 24. Come on.
Sirach chapter 39, verse 26. The principal things for the whole use of man's life are water, fire, iron, and salt.
Uh-huh.
Flour, wheat, honey, milk, and the blood of the grape. And oil.
And oil. And oil. And oil. Natural resource. Oil. Oil. Iraq was oil. Afghanistan was opium and oil. Iran is going to be for oil. Venezuela, oil. Okay, go ahead.
And clothing.
Come on.
All these things are for good to the godly.
All these things are for good for us, the godly, the Israelites. Go ahead.
Sold to the sinners.
Sold to the sinners, Esau, America, the United Snakes of America. Go ahead.
They are turned into evil.
They are turned into evil. dropping bombs on nations, setting up coup d'etats all for oil and resources. Okay, go back to Deuteronomy 33. Read that again about Asher.
Deuteronomy 33, verse 24. Mm-hmm. And of Asher he said, let Asher be blessed with children. Let him be acceptable to his brethren. Mm-hmm. And let him dip his foot in oil.
And let Asher dip his foot in oil. Now let's read this article. Read the title.
Oil and ideology.
Oil and ideology. Oil and ideology. Go ahead.
The truth behind U.S. interest in Venezuela.
Go down. Right there.
U.S. interest in Venezuela has nothing to do with humanitarianism and everything to do with defeating an ideological foe and stealing its resources.
And stealing its resources. Go ahead.
Argues Carol Bryan.
Go ahead.
Washington's onset of humanitarian.
So they're not going there to liberate the people. All of that is malarkey. All right. They'll film a 5 second, 10 second clip of some kind of march or whatever, and they say, oh, the president is not feeding the people. That's what they do. And they use the mouth of the beast to do that. To promote propaganda. To promote propaganda. Meanwhile, behind the scenes, there's all matters of evil going on. Okay, go ahead.
Washington's onset of humanitarian hysteria over Venezuela stretches even the most vivid of imaginations. To the United States, Nicolas Maduro represents the biggest ideological threat in Latin America. Accordingly, an orchestrated and well-funded propaganda campaign.
Oh, there's the word right there, propaganda campaign. Go ahead.
Is underway to justify regime change.
Go ahead.
This tried and tested tactic is employed whenever a leader refuses to get into bed with the U.S.
That's if you don't want to take that mark, meaning his ideology. Remember, the title said oil and ideology. That's the mark. If you don't want to, be in bed with the great whore and spiritually fornicate with her, guess what? They are going to remove you out of power. So America's trying to put in place a puppet president. And it is, you know what's crazy? All the other nations, nobody's saying anything. Everybody's quiet. How are you going to have a sitting president? Then you're going to have a Guido. They said that he went to school here. They're trying to raise him up to overthrow the current sitting president of a country. Who's sovereign? They have their own rights, their own laws, and so forth. It's crazy. It's just crazy. It's mind-boggling. Go ahead.
Whenever the U.S. dollars drop, or whenever the U.S. wishes to plunder the natural resources.
Because Venezuela is not using the U.S. dollar. They dropped the U.S. dollar. Go ahead. And remember, that's what Muammar Gaddafi wanted to do. Okay, so he was going against the agenda of the New World Order. Go ahead.
Resources of a sovereign nation. Mm-hmm. Or, if they're really unlucky, as in Venezuela's case, all three.
Go ahead.
This tactic has been employed with full effect against Saddam Hussein in Iraq, Muammar Gaddafi in Libya, and Bashar al-Assad in Syria. With the complicity of the mainstream media,
the mouth of the beast, the mouth of the whore, go ahead.
The UK government,
its allies, the 10 common markets, go ahead.
And the European Union.
There we go. The European Union is the part of the 10 common markets. Go ahead.
But it spectacularly failed with Hugo Chavez in Venezuela.
And they tried to assassinate Chavez, like we read in another article, multiple times. Go down. Okay. Go back to Isaiah 47. All right. So the Most High has different plans. All we got to do, brothers, we got to repent. We got to bring Northern Kingdom in. Lord willing, this word reaches places like Venezuela, Colombia, and so forth. And it will. All right. Because it's prophesied to happen. So there will be no New World Order of Edomites nor Moabite. I don't know where the hell that doctrine came in. All right. China ain't taking over a damn thing. All right. The New World Order are the Israelites. All right. Isaiah 47, verse 11 and verse 14.
Isaiah chapter 47, verse 11. Therefore shall evil come upon thee. Thou shalt not know from whence it riseth. And mischief shall fall upon thee. Thou shalt not be able to put it off. And desolation shall come upon thee suddenly, which thou shalt not know. Verse 14. Behold, they shall be as stubble.
The they that shall be as stubble is Esau, America. America, just in case you're confused, still read verse 1 and then go back to 14.
Isaiah 47, verse 1. Come down and sit in the dust, O virgin daughter of Babylon. Mm-hmm. Sit on the ground.
Come on.
There is no throne.
There's no throne. You're not in your kingdom of heaven no more. You're going to be in slavery. Go ahead.
O daughter of the Chaldeans.
Come on.
for thou shalt no more be called tender and delicate.
You ain't going to be called tender and delicate no more. Jump back to verse 14.
Verse 14, behold, they shall be as stubble. The fire shall burn them. They shall not deliver themselves from the power of the flame. There shall not be a coal to warm at, nor fire to sit before it.
Give me 1 Thessalonians 5 and 3. So what are we reading? The destruction of Babylon, okay? And the setting up of the New World Order under the Israelites. 1 Thessalonians 5 and 3. Come on.
1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 3. For when they shall say peace and safety.
When they shall say peace and safety. That's talking about Esau. Come on.
Then sudden destruction.
Then sudden destruction. Go ahead.
Cometh upon them.
Then sudden destruction cometh upon them. Because when that nukes are shot over here, they're not going to know. It's not going to be an alarm. The Most High is going to get rid of all of that. Okay, when you hear about the stars falling from heaven, those are the satellites. All of that's going to be shut down. It's going to be a surprise. That's how the Most High likes to get down. That's why Christ said, like a thief in the night. There's going to be no 911. Nope. That's going to be gone. It's going to be a surprise. All you're going to hear is boom. That's all you're going to hear. And death. Sudden death and destruction. There will be no new world order of Esau, no new world order of anything. We ain't going back into captivity, y'all. I hope y'all understand. So that's why it will behoove you to get your minds right so that when the chariots come, you will be delivered. Okay? You can make it into the wilderness. Lord's will, make it into the kingdom. Okay? That's the goal. That should be the goal of every man and woman here in IUIC. Okay? Give me Psalms 91. I want 2 to 3.
Psalms chapter 91, verse 1, verse 2. I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge and my fortress.
So that's how we're supposed to think. And this is what we're supposed to pray for. We're supposed to put the Lord first in everything. And the Lord is our refuge and fortress. Go ahead.
My God, in him will I trust.
Go ahead.
Surely he shall deliver thee from the snare of the fowler.
So the Most High will deliver us from the snare of the fowler. Come on, those are traps. Come on.
And from the noisome pestilence.
And from the noisome pestilence. We're about to read about this noisome pestilence. Go ahead.
He shall cover thee with his feathers, and under his wings shalt thou trust.
Come on.
His truth shall be thy shield and buckler.
And God's truth is making reference to what? Brothers, the Bible, the commandments. Go ahead.
Verse 5. Thou shalt not be afraid for the terror by night.
You shall not be afraid for the terror by night. Come on.
Nor for the arrow that flieth by day.
Nor for the arrow that flieth by day. That's making reference to the ICBMs. Those beautiful missiles just sitting in those silos, just waiting to be activated. Come on.
Nor for the pestilence that walketh in darkness.
Nor for the pestilence that walketh in darkness. Go ahead.
Nor for the destruction that wasteth at noonday.
Go ahead.
1,000 shall fall at thy side.
1,000 shall fall at thy side. This is talking about the wicked. This is talking about wicked Israelites and the other nations. Go ahead.
And 10,000 at thy right hand.
Come on.
But it shall not come nigh thee.
That's what we got to have faith in. It shall not come nigh thee. Why? Because we did everything in our power to the best of our ability to make sure that we will be delivered. That's talking about keeping the commandments sincerely in the faith of Christ. Go ahead.
Only with thine eyes shalt thou behold and see the reward of the wicked.
Read.
Because thou hast made the Lord, which is
because,
my refuge.
Because you have made the Lord what?
Has made the Lord, which is my refuge, even the Most High, thy habitation.
Go ahead.
There shall no evil befall thee.
Come on.
Neither shall any plague come nigh thy dwelling.
Go ahead.
But he shall give his angels charge over thee to keep thee in all thy ways.
Say lie to that. All right. Get me 2 Esdras. 2 Esdras chapter 6, 8 to 9. 2 Esdras 6, 8 to 9. Like I said before, there will be no new world order of anyone, of any of these nations, any of these heathens. Go ahead.
2 Esdras chapter 6, verse 8.
Come on.
He said unto me, from Abraham unto Isaac.
This is what this whole movie, this is like a movie, and we got different characters. The Most High is the executive. The Most High is the executive producer. He is the writer. He is the producer. And guess what? There's actors. There's people playing different characters. Every movie, you got what? You got a hero and a villain. In this great story, who's the hero? Who's the hero, brothers? Jacob. Who's the villain? Esau. That's what it's all about. It's always about Jacob and Esau. Everybody else, all the other actors and characters, they don't mean a damn thing. That's why in 2 Ezra chapter 6, verse 54, what does it say about the other nations? They be like unto spittle, like a vessel that falleth from a bucket, a drop of water from a bucket. It's always been about Jacob and Esau. Go ahead.
2 Ezra chapter 6, verse 8. Mm-hmm. And he said unto me, from Abraham unto Isaac, when Jacob and Esau were born of him, mm-hmm. Jacob's hand held first the heel of Esau.
So Jacob's hand held first the heel of Esau. Boy, that was a representation of rulership. Jacob was supposed to come after Esau's rulership. Right after Esau's downfall, Jacob is the next one to rule. Go ahead.
For Esau is the end of the world.
Esau is the end of the world, not Moab. Not Moab, get that out of your mind. Not Ishmael, get that out of your mind. Although I haven't heard that doctrine, but I did hear Moab is the next person to rule. That is garbage. That is not true. The Bible says Esau is the end of the world. Go ahead.
And Jacob is the beginning of it that follows.
So who's that new world order that comes right after Esau's downfall? Read it again.
And Jacob is the beginning of it that follows.
The nation of Israel is the beginning of it that follows. If you're still confused, that's talking about blacks, Hispanics, and natives. We are the ones that's going to rule right after America goes down. Go on.
The hand of man is betwixt.
The hand of man, that's the hand of the Moabite man. The hand of the Ammonite man. The hand of the Hamite man. The hand of the Ishmaelite man. Go ahead.
The hand of man is betwixt the heel and the hand.
Okay, that's talking about their little small role that they play in this. Okay, but in this great movie published by the Most High, it's always been about Jacob and Esau. Jacob and Esau. Okay, is that it?
Other question, Ezra, ask thou not.
Give me Daniel. Last one. Last scripture. Daniel. Daniel, Daniel, Daniel. Great prophet, Daniel. Let me get it. I want you to go to chapter 7. You know what I want, right? Take the kingdom.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. 18.
Go ahead.
Daniel chapter 7, verse 18. But the saints of the Most High shall take the kingdom.
What are we going to do, brothers?
Take the kingdom.
Take the kingdom. We're not going to ask for it.
Yes, sir.
We're not going to vote for it. We're going to take the kingdom. Go ahead.
And possess the kingdom forever, even forever and ever.
Keep reading.
Then I would know the truth of the fourth beast, which was diverse from all the others, exceeding dreadful, whose teeth were of iron, and his nails of brass, which devoured, breaking pieces, and stamped the residue with his feet.
Go ahead.
And of the 10 horns that were in his hand, and of the other which came up, and before whom three fell, even of that horn that had eyes, and a mouth that spake very great things.
Come on.
Whose look was more stout than his fellows.
Go ahead.
I beheld. And the same horn made war with the saints.
Come on, they made war with the saints. That's going into America. Go ahead.
And prevailed against them.
And put us into captivity. Come on.
Until the Ancient of Days came.
That's God. Come on.
And judgment was given to the saints of the Most High.
Come on.
And the time came that the saints possessed the kingdom.
And the time is going to come, brothers. We're going to possess the kingdom. Go ahead.
Thus he said, the fourth beast shall be the fourth kingdom upon earth, which shall be diverse from all kingdoms.
Go ahead.
And shall devour the whole earth.
Go ahead.
And shall tread it down and break it in pieces.
Go ahead.
And the 10 horns out of this kingdom are 10 kings that shall arise. And another shall rise after them. And he shall be diverse from the first. And he shall subdue three kings. And he shall speak great words against the Most High.
That's the so-called white man. Guess what? By him trying to establish a one world government, which God said hell no in the book of Genesis, chapter 11 with Nimrod. Antiochus tried to do the same thing to the Israelites, get them under a one world government to conform to their religion and so forth. The Most High shut all of that down. Now he's trying to do the same thing. He's speaking great words against the Most High by saying he is God, by saying that the people in Israel are the real Jews. All of that, he's speaking against the Most High God. Go ahead.
And shall wear out the saints of the Most High.
Most wore us out in slavery. Go ahead.
And think to change times.
And they change times, right?
And laws.
And they definitely change laws. Now two damn men could get married. Go ahead.
and they shall be given into his hand until a time and times and the dividing of time.
350 years, go ahead.
But the judgment shall sit.
But they shall do all of this, and they shall prosper at it. But the judgment shall sit. Go ahead.
And they shall take away his dominion.
We're going to take away his dominion. Go ahead.
To consume and to destroy it unto the end.
Read.
And the kingdom and dominion and the greatness of the whole kingdom, of the kingdom under the whole heaven, shall be given to the people of the saints of the Most High.
That's you, brothers. That's the Israelites. That's the Black, Hispanics, and Natives. That's us. God says the kingdom is going to be given to the people of the saints of the Most High, whose kingdom is what?
Whose kingdom is an everlasting kingdom. And all dominions shall serve and obey.
All dominions shall serve and obey. And why? Because we're going to have that rod of iron in our hand that you read about in Revelation 2, verse 26. The Moabites don't want to listen. Guess what? We're going to crack their head wide open. No more eating dog, bat, monkey meat. Nope. They are going to apply Leviticus 11. Okay? And even Esau, because a lot of times we like to talk about those kind of wild, unclean foods, and we just attribute it to Moab, but you got Edomites eating coyote, bear, squirrel, all sorts of stuff. Possum, and all of that. Esau be doing that too. Go ahead.
Hitherto is the end of the matter.
Hitherto is the end of the matter. What is the end of the matter? That the Israelites are going to rule at the end. Okay, the new world order is going to start with us, and it's never going to end. Read.
As for me, Daniel, my cogitations much troubled me, and my countenance changed in me, but I kept the matter in my heart.
But I kept the matter in my heart. All right, so all praises to the Most High God. That's the end of that. We're going to close it out.
We used to scream black power while Heron was pushed. But at the end of the day, nothing's in vain. IUIC has been given a vision. The tents of Judah has risen. Many has attempted the mission. Minor murmuring, omitting, and missing the mark. Just reading that he had the flame of fire in his eyes gave us the spark. We on Paul's mission. We out on the road, purple and gold, from Mexico, Cuba, Haiti, Ghana, Sierra Leone, 144,000 boots banging, concrete crackling. These are how our men repented at heart. The scriptures is proof. IUIC, we deliver the truth.